So we'll talk about stability control, traction control, ride control, yaw sensors, just plain ABS and issues, how they apply into the new stability control systems. Even get in a little bit about collision avoidance and collision mitigation, systems coming down the road to you. Kind of the point for some chassis classes. We've been seeing these pop up at conventions. Guys seem to be receiving them pretty well. It's kind of like TPMS. What happened in 2008?
Mandatory.
Tire pressure, mandatory, monitoring. What happens in 2012? Got to have stability control. So we're going to see a wide variety of how they do it, whether they do like a Cadillac or a Lincoln and integrate it into all the other systems, and so that stability control is really reaching out and doing a lot of things, or whether it's just a standalone add-on into the little, you know, puddle jumpers to just to, you know, pass federal motor vehicle safety standards. So let's go ahead and I think on the cover page, you've got a page below that. There's our table of contents. What we're going to do tonight, we're going to cover ride control systems operation. Just touch a little bit on air ride, but not much. And then get into ABS TCS theory review as it applies to stability systems. We'll talk about the ride-dependent systems more than the air rides. And lateral accelerometers, yaw sensors that go with stability control, multiple system interactions, networking, common diagnostic issues. So go ahead and look. Oh, we got some tool commercials here. Gee, you thought you had the only tool commercial? Here's one more tool commercial here. Tools of the trade here. And Pierre, this one's just for you because being a Volkswagen and Beamer technician, all right, almost said mechanic, that's a European term now, this guy is speaking in German.
Ja, hallo ihr Heimwerker. Jetzt zeigen wir euch mal eine richtige Obi-Hammer-Werbung. So, war was anderes, wir zeigen euch, wo der Hammer hängt. Ach so, probiert es zu Hause nicht aus, das tut weh.
Cool.
So, dann muss ich mal den Nagel auf den Kopf treffen.
Da bin ich gespannt. Wahnsinn, ey, Wahnsinn. Wahnsinn, super. Hammerhart.
Und?
Hammerhart, also ehrlich.
Finale der Hammerwerfer.
I've heard of hammer techs, but this guy is the hammer tech of all hammer techs. I saw people taking notes on that, too. I swear I did. Let's get a little bit more basic, okay? We're going to be like a locomotive. We're going to start at the very beginning of the track, some basic stuff, and we're going to get going, and we're going to get up and up and up with more deep stuff, okay? So just to make sure we're all on the same track, have a little review, never hurts, right? Let's go through some terms. I'm going to say the top one, and you guys look down through the list on the left and tell me which one of these A through J best is described by front springs with brake applied. So just 101 suspension review terms. Front springs with brake supplies. What do you think, guys?
G
has it. All right. How about manual selectable ride system, MSR, manual selectable ride system. F has it. Excellent. How about a damper's expansion? What's a damper? Mr. Obvious asks. Shock or strut, a damper's expansion. What'd you say?
H,
Henry, rebound. Viscosity reacts to magnetic field. J, magneto-rheological fluid, spreads force out over time. Spreads force over time.
I say dampening?
Damping, exactly. Oh, wait a minute. Does a damper do that? When your car hits a huge hole and that energy is going to go straight into your spine, if you had a wooden kitchen chair sitting on top of the frame and steel wheels like a wagon, no springs even under the wagon seat, right? And to get rid of that energy that's going to be transmitted directly to you, what do? You spread it out over time. And what device does that? This Mr. Obvious stuff, right? What device does it? How about the coil spring? Now, we'll talk about what we do with the coil spring's oscillations. In a second, pumps or motors control springs. A pump or motor controls springs.
Aye.
Fully active. Suspension, rear springs on acceleration.
E.
Squat. Limits spring oscillations. Now, damping, right? Limits springs oscillations. How's it limit it? What's it? Energy doesn't go away. It just changes forms, right? So what's it change into? The limitation of those oscillations. Kind of like coil oscillations. You put a capacitor on, gives a place for the current to go, that spike to go. When you have oscillations of a spring, coil spring, leaf spring, torsion bar, whatever, air spring, what's the damper turn that into?
Heat energy.
Heat energy, exactly. Non-electronic suspension is passive suspension. And what the front springs do on acceleration? We've got one left. It does a lift. Okay. So we're going to cover a lot of these terms as we go through this getting to know electronic suspension. Let's give a little bit more review here. We all know those are leaf springs. Those are coil springs. Those are torsion bars. We all know these are sources of leaks. All right? Air springs. And we all know that there's a piston and a cylinder and oil and not always, but on some shocks or struts, oil with what?
Pressure.
Nitrogen gas, okay, under pressure to keep the bubbles down and so forth. And I think we all know also, on slide 3, that this disc and this orifice inside the piston, as the piston moves up and down in the cylinder of the shock or strut, that the calibration to make it a soft or a hard, stiff, for like more off-road or sport, is the name of the game. And in racing vehicles, anybody do any racing where you actually take shocks apart and recalibrate them with the different discs? That's done for a lot of off-road Baja stuff. Can any of these systems do that? Sure, you bet, with either an electromagnetic field or a solenoid, one or the other. So we'll get into that and the complex of systems, complexity, and the simpler systems that are standalone and so forth. And speaking of so forth, slide 4, the big pile of dimes. I don't know how much that would be worth, but it would be considerable. I'd like to have a dime for every time I've seen one of these guys, either a Lincoln Continental or a Navigator or something doing the old dragging down the highway because the air suspension system shot. Our old friend Sam Momello with Two Guy Garage, seen him on YouTube the other day, the Y-O-U, tube, G, by the way, and he was peddling those orange springs in the kit to put the light out and get rid of the air suspension entirely, because we know that one of those kits costs what it costs to replace just one leg of the system on these vehicles. Are you guys selling those, I'm assuming? Those kits, you bet. Are you fixing them factory also? Back to normal, restoring them? What goes wrong with them? I like this guy, wrote a book called Ecclesiastics. He's quoted as saying, there's nothing new under the sun. Isn't that true? The older you get, are you finding what I'm getting? The older I get, the more I see the same old crud being recycled and given a new name, maybe add a couple wires to it in a module, but it's the same stuff over and over again. And so when we look at this system, we go, hey, I've seen sensors and pumps and some kind of a control, and I've seen air, maybe air shocks for air ride leveling. Wow, that dates back to what, the 60s or something like that? And what was the same things going wrong then that go wrong now? This gets crummy because it's sitting back there in places like Indiana, New Jersey, where they have a love affair with salt on the roads. So you guys do sand or salt?
Salt.
Yeah, we do the salt too. So, you know, my car's rusting in the driveway at home as we speak. And these things go bad and give a false input. In the case of the older vehicles, it's just some switches and so forth. But in this system, like on a Lincoln, you've got a module. It turns the pump on. Also, what can turn the pump on? It can be telling the truth, because what happens? You got a hose. You got dry rot. If we look at a picture here, here's Ben Franklin. His famous saying was, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Now, you've got little leaks and so forth. You tell your customer, fix it early, cheap. You're already telling them this, right? Fix it later, expensive, or buy a Chrysler, and now you actually have a Fiat. Fix it again, Tony, right? That's what Fiat stood for, if you didn't realize that. So anyways, there's not a whole lot new about this system, except maybe some caveats of where we're doing the module work. If we turn the page to page 7, Now here's just a sensor, like we see in the Lincoln, but this is just for air height. So this is for air shocks or air rear struts, whatever you want to call them, like on a late 90s Cadillac that doesn't have any other system, just has automatic leveling control. And we've got a couple of driver circuits, some QDRs, inside this this height sensor. And there's our one piece. What you see is all you get there, solid line. There's the pump. There's the mechanical valve with the vacuum hoses going to the rear struts. There's the vent with a little filter on it, I'm sure. And here's our exhaust solenoid. We make a little loop over there, and we get our ground from that sensor. And we get our power over here through this relay. We're going to kick on with compressor control. So to turn on the pump, we're going to turn this on. To turn it off and to vent it, we're going to turn the other one on. And so basically, it's just as you've been doing for years and years. Nothing new. Now we'll move forward a slide. Now it's a little bit new. So nothing new under the sun. We're taking the old stuff and just repackaging it. Now we have something called a CVRSS. Anybody worked on that system? CVRSS. Continuously Variable Road Sensing Suspension. A little newer, late 90s into the 2000s. And actually, even some early 90s stuff. But the early 90s stuff was Rube Goldberg. The early 90s stuff was standalone systems that didn't talk on the data bus, meaning you can't get your scan tool to talk to it, get PIDs and so forth. An example was a 93-94 Cadillac that had a Packard electric ride control module. You may be thinking, Packard? Let's see, Packard builds old cars, like Richie Cunningham would ride around in Happy Days, and they also built and build great connectors and terminals and wires and things like that. What are they doing in the module business? Well, years ago, General Motors, before they even had a term called Delphi, General Motors had all these component groups, you know, like AC spark plug and AC Rochester, Delco Remy, Delco Electronics, and those guys were sometimes, you know, put against each other to see how we can compare, maybe a backup. Packard was a backup to Delco Electronics for modules. They made the first steering wheel controls, and they made the first ride control. And you raise the trunk on the Caddy, let's say about a 94, 95, it's got this black box when you tear the trim out of the back of the Caddy and the trunk area, and you push a little jumper into a connector, and an LED in the top of the box blinks codes. And that's how you diagnosed and fixed them. It was either one height or the other, not height, one stiffness or the other. It wasn't continuously variable, but it was a road sensing type suspension. We'll get a little bit more into the inputs than that in a minute. This one right here, the CVRSS, this is a full-fledged serial bust module. I call them sometimes MUXed, as short for multiplexed, AE, it's IE, it's on the serial data bus. You can talk with your scanner. And its job was had a little side work on the side here. It's controlling the compressor and the exhaust with the module as opposed to the sensor. What would be the sensor inputs to tell this particular vehicle that has ride control, not just leveling control, but ride control, what the rear is doing? Where would it know? We used to have one sensor, right, from the 60s, you know, even up to the recent Lincoln Navigator or whatever that didn't have ride control but had suspension leveling, automatic leveling control. Now we have ride control. What sensors would be telling us what the rear is doing? Any clues? What sensor? If you had automatic leveling control in conjunction with ride control, what would tell the module that does both jobs what the back was doing? Those ride sensors, right? Those little potentiometer. We're going to talk about those, how they fail and how to test them. And you probably already tested them. Or if you're not, you're testing something just like them. There's a picture of the active suspension, semi-active suspension. Fully active suspension is some pretty Buck Rogers stuff you see in some Land Rovers and some select Euro luxury cars and so forth, where you actually can pull a wheel up before it goes in a hole. And that requires pneumatics or hydraulics, and it's, you know, very expensive, very complex. Anybody worked on any of those fully automatic suspension vehicles? What was your experience?
Mercedes
had it. What was wrong with it?
BAS module.
Okay, the module. I'm sure that wasn't cheap, was it?
For a Benz.
Oh, for a Benz. Okay, yeah. All right. So here's a semi-active strut, shock, whatever you want to call it, with a solenoid in the side. What's the solenoid's job? Control what? Control fluid flow, moving the shock into a stiffer or a softer ride. And there's the actuator in the top and some. Sometimes it's in the side. Depends on if it's shock or strut. And it's basically a solenoid. You current ramp it, look and see what it's doing, just like you'd be looking at an injector. Now, if you don't have a solenoid, you have an electromagnetic field. You have a little coil that doesn't have any moving parts, and you have that fluid, magnetorheological fluid. And what you can actually do, you can go to your brake lathe back at the shop, get some of the dust, you know, from the job, put it in the bottom of a glass jar, and then pour some vegetable oil in there. Make you a nice little, you know, murky-looking silver paste. And you put plastic spoon in, spoon just moves around nice and easy, stirring around. Put a big magnet, get the biggest old magnet you've got on the side of your toolbox. Underneath that jar, guess what's going to happen to that paste-like substance? It's going to turn into like hardened paint or something like that. And other uses for this, it really abounds. There's a demonstration of it here. This guy's got a magnet he can turn off and on. And there's that liquid. There's a bunch of metal shavings, basically iron particles. You add a fluid, just basically oil. Yeah, and the different viscosity of the oils that they use for different applications. But he pulls it out, and it's just kind of dripping off. He turns the magnet on. He pulls it out. It's almost a solid. So that's what they're doing inside those shocks and struts. That magnerite is what GM labeled it. And GM's not the only ones using it now, because Delphi had that. I mean, that was their kind of their invention, claim to fame. But when they slimmed down in the mid-2000s, become a smaller company, they sold some stuff off. And the U.S. chassis division was one of them. And the Chinese company, BWI, bought that. And so they're doing some other cars, as well as General Motors, with the magnerite. It's all over Europe. And the uses, washing machine dampers, prosthetic, you know, artificial limbs, exercise equipment. Here's one more, bulletproof vests. That's not been perfected yet, so the cops aren't wearing them, nor are they out there in the military applications. But military applications were probably the most likely place we'll see MR fluid. Can you imagine a really flexible, jelly kind of filled vest, maybe that thick, and then when a gunshot goes off, or if the soldier has a manual switch, like they get into a firefight, that field, just like in a heated seat, you know, you have a bunch of grid pattern, that field turns that movable liquid into a very hard steel. And then the bullets can't penetrate. Of course, you know, you're all stiff and everything, but it's a, you know, small price to pay if you're out there getting shot at. So they haven't perfected that yet, but I mean, they can do that because they've got sensors that can detect a high speed or a high rate of audio, like my hearing aids. When a gunshot goes off or something loud gets dropped in the shop, they just shut down for a second, just like that. So it protects my ears from over-amplification if something's already loud enough for even a deaf guy, old guy like me to hear. So look for bulletproof vests to have this stuff. A lot of uses for it, and we'll be seeing this more and more. It becomes cheaper in just the average everyday shock absorbers out there in the normal vehicle usage. Semi-active suspension overview. Obviously, we know what these guys are on 12. They're tires, and there's our McPherson struts and some rear struts or shocks. There's our module in the middle, and there's our height sensors, four of them. And those are the potentiometers we want to talk about. Speed-sensitive steering. What would be an interaction? Looks like an output of that module. They may have the same module that does ABS do speed-sensitive steering. That happens. They may have the same module that does vehicle theft deterrent do speed-sensitive steering. No relationship between VTD. I think I was out here, last April, and I did a vehicle theft deterrent class, and I may have brought one of those pass-lock/EVO modules, electronic variable orifice. What's the connection? There's no connection. It's just a business case to put both parts in one box and share one board and one plastic connector and one power and ground, but there was no connectivity to make the steering stiffer when the car is being stolen. We also may put the speed-sensitive steering in with the ride control system. And obviously, if we get on a rougher road, we could do the interaction of the system. Since we are having an output to control the coil at the bottom of the steering shaft, going right into the pinion gear and the rack. Since we're controlling a field in there to make it harder to turn, so you have more of the feel of the road, or to make it easier to turn, actually kind of boost you a little bit, boost the hydraulic assist of power steering, we can have that output react to rough roads. If you're in a rough road, do you want a nice, easy steering system? Or you want a little bit more stiffer steering suspension? So there's the angle there. Vehicle speed, of course, is an input. The faster you go, the more stiffer you want the suspension to be. What do you think these guys are? They look like big old horn buttons from way back, right, to me. They could be one or more deceleration sensors. So depending on the make and the model, they may use deceleration sensors that are separate, or they may use data from a PCM. Talk about that here in a little bit. Page 13, listed some pictures of some sensors. We all recognize that. Anybody tell me what that's out of? Our transmission guy? Is that TOS out of maybe a hydromatic or something? Transmission output speed sensor, TOSS. What, that's an input. We talked about that. The faster you go, might have a little stiffer ride. And we've seen these go bad. How many people have replaced one of these yet? How much was it?
I replaced one on a Grand Marquis. I'm trying to think. I don't know if it was 54 or 154.
What, two nights ago, was it UPR or somebody else said $250 on a Cadillac, either Cadillac or Denali, something like SUV, about $250. And if you look at them, I mean, it's really, really cheap. I think I've got a blow-up picture right there. There you go. This is the front of a 09 Escalade hybrid. Of course, a hybrid matters nothing in this particular conversation. It just happens to be one. There's the exhaust manifold breathing down its neck. There's all kinds of crap getting splashed on it. Looks like a harness. This is how I found it. Looks like a harness if somebody was doing a brake job or something and maybe pushed it up just an inch or so and over. Looks like the harness is going to get chafed as this moves up and down, because this thing basically just rotates like this. At each end, there's an end attached to the chassis suspension member, the lower control arm, and then this is, of course, bolted to the frame. So looking at the suspension member versus frame, that activity, we don't really care about whether it's here or here as we might in active suspension, where we'd actually want to keep the wheel from dropping into the hole by pumping up a suspension member. We would just watch for the movements, and not just movement in general, but the change, the rate of change. I'm going to use a word throughout the evening called delta. The delta TPS, or delta in this case, delta ride height sensor. Delta ride, the delta means how fast something's changing. If you look at a potentiometer, if it's on an HVAC flat pack motor or on a TPS, or in this case, on a suspension, and you see it going from a half a volt on your scope, maybe doing a 5-second time base, whatever, and you're sweeping it, and it goes from half a volt to 4.5 volts, about like that, that's not a very steep climb. But if you see it go from half a volt to 5 volts in, 1 second or less, that's a steep climb, that's a big delta. When we see a great delta of TPS, that's time to pour the fuel on. That's time to get extra pulses of fuel into the engine. We see a great delta of our ride position sensor. That's time to immediately make that shock absorber up here stiffer, because we are on the rough road. I mean, it picks it up, and it changes a couple of times a second. Back to pictures here. So PCM, what will be some inputs from the PCM? Obviously, this doesn't go directly into the, I call everything FRED. Everybody knows that, right? Frustrating, ridiculous electronic devices. If we have, this is an obvious direct input to a ride control sensor, right? So what's the position of the chassis doing? What's the rate of bumpiness? This would probably be sent to that ride control sensor, or ride control module, how? Via the PCM or TCM, wherever's got our VSS, we know how fast we're going. How about steering angle sensor? That might be a prime input to electric power steering. It might have to be shared with the ride control. Let's talk about that. Why would we have a steering angle sensor input to a ride control system? Soft or hard ride? What you're doing here? Yeah, now if I'm those delta term again, if I'm making a bunch of changes really quick with the steering wheel, do I want a soft shock or strut or a stiff one? I want a stiff one. I want to feel like a race car. All right? If I'm making little subtle changes as I'm driving, low delta, low rate of change, then I want this shock or strut to be softer. Inputs also that the ride control module would want from the PCM. We had some terms a minute ago. Squat, dive, and lift. Let's talk about when those terms apply and what kind of PIDs we'd see from squat, dive, and lift. When does a vehicle squat? And which wheels squat? Which shocks and springs squat?
The rear.
When you do what?
Accelerate.
So when you get a significant or enough within the software limit of the TPS, what do we call it when it does this real fast?
Delta.
When you get a great enough delta TPS, PCM is going to send a message to the ride control module and say, we've got hard acceleration going on. So the ride control module says, I know what's going to happen before it happens. Back shocks are going to squat. What's the rear struts going to do? They're going to lift. So we stiffen them both up at the right time, and the car just takes off flat with good trim height, good headlight angle, good handling, and you just don't feel this kind of stuff going on. How about if I, one module I left out of here, but how about ABS? Would ABS factor in with a fully integrated ride control system? Not a standalone we might hang on some cars, but one that's fully integrated, like a luxury vehicle. Would braking, ABS, when you hit that brake stroke sensor, we're going to be looking at that and going, wow, that was just a tap of the brake. Or no, that was, wow, that was on the brake hard. We're going to have dive. So the front shocks and springs are going to compress. And they're going to be a rebound, so before they even get a chance to compress, we'll stiffen them up. How about this guy? You recognize that? Looks like a yellow one there. You know, sometimes yellow means airbags, right? How about an accelerometer? They have those in the inflatable restraint systems and airbag systems. What's an how accelerometer work? It works a little bit like a map sensor. Have you ever thought or read or somebody told you how the inside, or maybe you cut one open, a map sensor, they've got a little wafer in there made of silicon, and when that wafer in a map, or fuel vapor pressure sensor, whatever the case, maybe it's in the side of the vacuum booster. But a pressure sensor, when that little wafer gets flexed as vacuum or pressure pushes or sucks on it, that wafer, silicon wafer, changes its resistance. And that's measured in the electronics of the sensor, and that becomes, let's say, a half a volt to 4.5 volt analog signal. That's what's going on in the map sensor, on the manifold, and other applications of pressure sensors like that. This is similar, many of them, not all of them work that way, but this one, when you have a mass attached to that wafer, and that mass is attached to the body of the frame of the vehicle, and the vehicle starts slowing down, what's the mass going to do? It's going to be like that junk on the back seat, right? It's going to start sliding forward and fall on the floor. So that mass moves and makes that wafer flex, and as that wafer flexes, a little resistance change turns into a little voltage, analog voltage change. We've got ourselves an output. Now, do all accelerometers, whether it's a lateral accelerometer or variations of these that check for yaw, do they all have analog outputs? The latest ones I've looked at for yaw sensing, and I'll give you a little demonstration of the difference between lateral acceleration and yaw. Y'all watch football. So you know when you have lateral acceleration, it's like a lateral pass. It's to the side, right? So when the car is broad sliding, which is what you get into when in a corner, rear drive cars too hard in a corner, or front wheel drive just can't make the corner. Front wheel drive just can't make the corner. It's called understeer, right? And with understeer, you get a degree sometimes of the sideways motion. So this is lateral acceleration this way. And if you have a rear drive car especially, or if you pull the parking brake up on your front wheel drive car and turn to the left in the snow, what's the back end want to do? Become the steering wheels, right? And so now you get that. That's called yaw. So this is yaw, and then this is lateral. So there are accelerometers for either type. Sometimes they're combination units. Sometimes they're mechanical, some older days. Most of them are electronic now. The latest ones I've looked at, looking at like some 010, 09 stuff, pull the console up. They always put it in the middle of the vehicle on the floorboard usually. You pull the console up, there this unit is, and I go, hey, it's got two wires. Must be a smart sensor. Now, when I open my air cleaner up and change my air filter, that's got two wires, but that's not a smart sensor, is it? That's a what? The thermistor, right? Variable resistor with temperature. When I see two wires on something that's detecting degrees of rotation, I got to think that must be some kind of a smart sensor. So I got to looking at it, investigating, you know, scoping it, reading up about it. It's a CAN bus sensor. So it's got its own ground. It's getting power off of the CAN bus, believe it or not, and it makes a signal out of that CAN on that CAN message. Now, not every two-wire sensor, not every smart sensor, we'll call it that way, not every smart sensor is sending out a CAN bus message to tell you what the yaw is. In that case, you really can't back probe it and test anything, can you? You're at the mercy of your scan tool. Now, you can put a scope on there, but what's that going to tell you? I got a square wave that's sporadic, some asynchronous pulses, and then I don't have one. I don't have one at all, ever, keys on, whatever. Hey, the bus is shorted. My scan tool probably won't work. So either it's got a message or it don't. You can't tell if it's a good message or not. So you're at the mercy of watching the scan tool, and hopefully your scan tool can read that particular PID. Now, not every two-wire sensor, not every bus sensor is putting out a message on a bus. I should say not every smart sensor putting out a message on a bus. Some accelerometers used in side airbag sensors. So when the side airbag needs to go off, we got a sensor in the door panel, not the door panel, the B pillar, or maybe on the floorboard or whatever next to the B pillar. When that sensor senses a significant side impact, not a shopping cart, something greater than that, we got to get the side airbag out, right? Well, typically the module that deploys a side airbag is something under the seat, right? Sensing diagnostic module, something like that. What's Ford call them? SIS or SIM or whatever. But anyways, the main airbag module that deploys the side airbag, it's looking for this side impact sensor. It's got two wires on some models. I've seen some on the front, the frontal airbag sensors. They're auxiliary sensors to supplement the sensors actually in the airbag for frontal collisions. There also can be some two wires. And you go, well, how's a two-wire sensor work? It's got to have power and ground. In this case, it's not like some of the two-wire ABS wheel speed sensors we're going to talk about later. This is a sensor which has got power and ground, and the power is 5 volts, and the ground is, of course, 0. It comes from the sensing airbag module, the main airbag module, and this is how it works. It has, let's say, 100 milliamps of current draw, and then all of a sudden it has 50 milliamps. Then it has 100. And then it has 50. Guess what it does as it goes from high to low? It makes a pulse train. It makes a square wave. It constantly does this 50, 100, 50, 50, 100, 100, 100, 100, 50, 50. You see what I'm doing? I'm doing Morse code with current draw. So instead of using voltage to bring a bus up and down, I'm just taking the two wires that the thing works off of to think, and I'm just making the little logic circuit in that module go higher, lower, higher, lower. And that message is, I'm here. I'm the right side impact sensor, and I'm fine. I'm plugged in. If the module under the seat doesn't see that, it says, oh, turn the airbag light on. But if it does see it, it says, hey, we're fine. We're not blowing the side airbag. Now we change that off, on, off, on. I should say high, low of the current, and we make it so the side impact sensor tells the main airbag module, it's time to blow the bag because a significant enough force was felt. So we're going to start seeing more of this kind of stuff, more of these sensors that either have a CAN bus message coming out of them, or another kind of bus message, nothing you can read with the scanner, but could you read a high-low, high-low current? Certainly. Anybody current ramping? Yeah, a lot of you guys are current ramping, so you could scope the current on some of these sensors, once you know how they work. By the way, got to give a little disclaimer here. You got to do a lot of digging to know how stuff works. I'm preaching to the choir here because you're all out here on a cold, snowy night because you want to learn all you can about how stuff works. Yes?
You're saying if you current ramp that and the it's constantly changing its milliamps just as a normal feedback, and then if it sees a change...
Yeah, and then you wouldn't be able to read that, okay, I saw 350 milliamps, and I'm making up numbers. I don't know if it's 200 to 250 or what, but you see 50, 50, 50, 100, 100. There's nothing, there's no documentation that's going to tell you that that was a I'm okay message or I'm crying wolf, I think I've been hit. But at least you can tell the thing's alive. So if it's pulse and current, it's alive.
So if it sets a code for that?
There'd be a code, right. There should be a code. If the software was written correctly... We all have no-code drivability problems and no-code ABS problems, and, you know, that's our life.
Right.
But
how could you confirm then that by testing amperage, if it's good or bad?
I think more likely you'd confirm you got good wiring.
Right.
If you just did a quick amp check. You got a code that says side impact sensor, not there.
But you could get a CAN bus failure if you have a bad wiring problem to something that's going to give you...
Right, CAN bus failure.
Bus failure, you're going to get a CAN bus error.
Right, you're going to get, if it's intermittent. I mean, if the CAN bus is down, it's down. You're not reading anything with any meter, with any scan tool.
Right, then you'll get a bunch of errors.
Yeah. You're going to look for the whole wiring harness, trying to find where the short or the short is. But on these sensors that are just using current draw on their supply lines to do the Morse code signaling, like a CAN bus message, but not a CAN bus message, where current turns on and off, higher or lower, to make the message that the module reading that current sees. If you want to diagnose that beyond, okay, there's a code, slap a module on, you could just put your amp clamp on there real quick and see it going ding, 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 ding. What's that told you? The module's at least trying to work and the wiring's good. But if you see no movement of your current draw, then you suspect a bad module. You're checking for powers and grounds, obviously. All right, last little sensor in here. Not really a sensor. How about this input right here? We're talking about ride control. Why in the world would I want the transmission shift levers doing for ride control? Yeah, if you're over here in this position, does that mean you want good gas mileage and you want a nice, easy shift?
Nope.
That means you want to have some fun. You've got those paddles on the Grand Prix, you know, the Bonnevilles on the steering wheel, or you've got this, you know, on your Dodge or whatever. You slap it over there, just slap it, you know, up and down. So you want stiff suspension. So whenever you go to the manual shift feature of an automatic transmission, we're going to have that input also. And it may be a bus message on later models. You guys know this deal, right? Older cars, we're looking for a lot more wiring, a lot more inputs to back probe. Newer cars, it's just going to be, that's going to be going to the PCM, TCM. And we're going to be looking for a bus message into the ride control module. Tell us what's going on there. So we've already talked about all these in detail. These are all descriptions. We've seen that picture a second ago. By the way, this particular had no code, and it did have a complaint of a little bit of a hard ride, a little bit of noise and kind of a funny noise in the right front, a hard ride. And so I got to looking and didn't really see anything that jumped out in front of me with a scan tool, back probed this just like I would a TPS. So I went into my reference ground and the signal, like a half a volt or so, you know, sitting there with weight on the vehicle. Actually, I popped off the little linkage, which is just on this model, popped on just like the side of a throttle cable on an old throttle body. A little ball and socket type push fit, popped it off. Back probed it, moved it like that. My Fluke meter seemed to, you know, do its automatic shift as it moved from, you know, volt or two, whatever, up into the 5-volt range. Then I put my picoscope on it, and it's like, hey, that's pretty good. Hey, what's this? Saw the dropout. So just like you'd have a no-code diagnostics, but maybe you suspect it's a TPS, and you scope sweep your TPS, you're doing the same thing down here. What do we say? What does Solomon say? Nothing new under the sun. We're just changing some of the things we're doing in drivability, moving it down here on suspension control systems. So we talked about steering angle, a little bit about yaw, the difference between yaw or lateral accelerometers. Could be multiplex. That's what MUX means. Multiplex, short for MUX is short for that. Direct or digital direct. Transmission gear, we talked about that. All right, 16. There's the outputs, and we're getting 2 hertz into them. Left front, right front dampers, and so forth. So there's the solenoids and the shocks and struts, or dampers, if you want to use a generic term. 2 hertz. Now, there's another system out there that doesn't use these and does these at 1 hertz. So instead of two times a second, we can change these and give an average stiff or soft. We can do 1 time a second, not quite as reactive, but still variable sensing suspension, but not have to use any of those. What could we use in place of ride height chassis sensors? One of my bullets on my objectives tonight was to talk about systems interaction. Kind of stuff that you don't really put that much detail sometimes in that theory of operation in the service manual. I mean, really, if you think about service manuals these days, you got 3 things. Schematics, theory of operation, well, besides R&R, which most of you guys don't need a book to tell you how to tear something apart. I mean, like all you guys. But schematic, theory of operation, and flowcharts. Flowcharts. Everybody a fan of flowcharts? Love flowcharts? You love flowcharts? Use them every day, right? 19 pages, 2.5 hours. What's wrong with flowcharts? Why are they complex? Why do they not lead you where they need to go? I say this in every class. You go to Detroit, and take a tour, and you'll get your answer. You seen the movie Mad Max? All right? That's Detroit these days. Some neighborhoods, you never know anything's wrong. Other neighborhoods, you can't get a bus. I think 40% of the people who live in the inner city of Detroit don't have a car, or 60%. 6% don't have a car. The bus service, they don't go through 4 miles of nothing, wasteland, burnout buildings, I mean, nothing. There's no population, maybe the crack houses or something. And so, like, the churches are reaching out, and they're sending the church buses out to pick people up and take them to work because there is no bus service and people don't own cars. It's just, the city is so, there's more empty area in Detroit than the entire area of San Francisco. You can take San Francisco and fit it inside the empty sections of Detroit. You go out in the suburbs, some areas look fine. You go down Delphi Drive, things are bustling and so forth. You go out to some other place like Pontiac, and it's like, wow. I see trees going up through the sidewalk in front of a huge, nice new building that used to be an engineering building or a manufacturing facility. Things are shutting down. It is getting to be really kind of scary. Where are all those jobs gone? I don't mean to get political, but China. He's pointing that way. It must be the direction for China, right? Out the door, right? Well, who's writing the service manuals? Who's validating software? Who's validating flowcharts? Fewer and fewer people doing the job of, you know, sometimes 20 people doing the job of 200. And so there's not enough time to get all that done. So what does that relate to you? That means you got to scrap and get every bit of little bit of information you can everywhere you can, and especially the theory of operation down tight, the basics and advanced stuff of electronic diagnosis and schematic interpretation. And because you're just not going to be able to follow those flow charts with a lot of confidence. Am I speaking the truth?
Yeah. Yep.
All right. So back to the absence of this. I've got this system, but I don't have sensors. There's systems out there called body control damping. GM used it for a few years. Body control damping. Now, ride control damping was using the ride height sensors to determine that delta changes, to determine whether we need to stiffen or soften the shock absorbers. Body control damping works a lot like passive TPMS. Now, you guys have probably all had the active TPMS classes, right? where they talk about those radio transmitters, you know, the Schrader, the Pacific, and all the different designs and the frequencies and the as my colleague Dave Skater calls it, the the hokey pokey you got to do to reset the tire sensors and all that stuff. But is there any other way of doing tire pressure monitoring on a vehicle?
Wheel speed,
exactly. Wheel speed slower because the tire is more inflated than the other tire is faster because it's smaller because it's got less air in it. Could you do that quickly? Now, most of those passive TPMS systems, it takes a couple miles of driving to figure out, hey, right front tire is a little low.
It's a little bit of time on the other ones, too.
That's true. For the radio, everything, that'll sync up and work. But we can take sudden changes in tire speed and do one of two things. Determine it's a rough road for ride control damping, for body control damping. Tire does this, it's smaller. It's a bump, boom, pushes in on it. It's smaller, it turns faster. Boom, it expands out of the bump, it turns slower. Or we can say, we can take that rough road information, we're already using it for what? For something else, drivability. Yeah, for P0300s. Now, if it's P0, I've never been on a road where I set a 301 or 306. Like, wow, that'd be a cool road that every six-cylinder, you know, boom, boom, boom with the tire. But we've been on rough roads that a 300 might have set had there not been that PID on the scanner that says rough road detected. Because, you know, everything it does, the tire does the half shaft, does the transmission, does crankshaft, makes the engine crankshaft a little erratic, which makes the ECM think it's misfiring. We can also take that same data, you know, that's pretty real time, misfire detection, rough road detection for misfire attenuation, the software program, we attenuate it, we make it so it's not as picky about watching a crankshaft while we're on the rough road. That's the bottom line. We can take that real-time information and we can make the shock stiffer. But it's not as fast as a sensor doing this, so we're only doing 1 hertz outputs. So if you don't see those sensors we talked about, but you've got damper solenoids or coils for that MR fluid, a magnetride system, then look for 1 hertz instead of 2 hertz on your scope. And you can just also, it's a coil, it's a solenoid, so you can just do what you do with a fuel injector, right? Look at the waveform. Okay, a couple of wires here. ICCS data link left, ICCS data link right. Now, this vehicle is not quite new enough to be CAN. And it's left and right, not high and low anyways, right? The data is 333 hertz. And it's pulse width modulated. So here's data that's not the data bus that your scan tool reads, but it is data that you could see with the scope. Now, ICCS stands for Integrated Chassis Control System. So when you go rooting around underneath a Cadillac, for example, and you see a module, an ABS hydraulic modulator assembly, I should say, with the two brake lines going in and the four coming out, and you look at the label, sometimes they're real nice. They say left front, right front, you know, on the brake lines. The label part number, if it says ICCCS, it might also say MISVA, ABS, or DBC 7.0, MISVA, well, DBC, Dynamic Brake Controller, MISVA, Magnetic Steering Variable Assist, a variable, you know, steering system. Some of them will say ICCS. That means that module is doing two or three other things besides just ABS. It's working the ride control. It's working with the ride control. So it's a more integrated system. Down here in the bottom, we're seeing discrete inputs into the CVRSS. That's the module back in the trunk typically for the ride control system. Coming from the PCM, and look what it says. Lift from acceleration and VSS. So we could couple these two wires in like a 2008 model on the CAN bus and make it so your scanner can read all that. Otherwise, we're going to be having to talk to what? You could talk to this on a multiplex system where we're putting all that information on the bus, or if you had a scan tool that could talk to the ride control module, you could just talk to that and see if you're getting lift when you stomp on the accelerator, if you're getting dive when you stomp on the brakes. All right. Now, let's take a little moment to go through some ABS, because ABS, so we kind of zoomed up a little bit with ride control. Now we're going to come back down, put the locomotive in lower gear, and then work our way up into ABS, which leads into TCS, which leads into stability control. Things like ESP and VSIS and what's the Beamer's column?
DSC.
VSC on Toyota. So whatever the name it goes by, I like to call it traction control for cornering. So to get into all that, let's do a little quick review here, make sure we're all on the same page. Page 18, pressure at the brake caliper. Pressure at the brake caliper. He is right. Braking force. Isolation valve off, on, isolation valve on, pump off. Isolation valve on, pump off. D is right. Pressure maintain mode. Tires hold on road surface. Tires hold on the road surface. Coefficient of friction. Pump motor and solenoids off. By the way, I have two Ds, so we're going to call this one down here 2D1. Or D1. D1 and D2, okay? D1 and D2. Pump, motor, and solenoids off. B is right. Normal braking mode. Rain, snow, or ice. Plenty of that these days. Not the rain part. We prefer the rain part, right? Road covering. H. ABS inactive. ABS inactive. I has it. Rest mode, gravel, tar, cement, or blacktop. Road covering. G, accumulator chamber fills up. Accumulator chamber fills up. Pressure decrease mode, D2. And wheels turn faster or slower, and I'll explain that, than the road speed. Wheels slip, see Charlie. Pump and isolation valve, both are on. Pump and isolation valve both on. Best one of these answers. F, pressure increase mode. Okay, let's move into it. This is real basic, but this stuff, guys, has changed in just the last 4 or 5 years with ABS. We've got to know ABS, TCS, get into stability control, because stability control is basically TCS for cornering. Remember this guy? You took your A5, right? You got to keep going back to the simple stuff, so you can pass your ASE, remember metering valves. What did it do? I had two guys last night that, at break time, come up to me and goes, now, I want to make sure I get that right. And that's okay, you know, because if you're not doing a lot of brake work, and you have, it's been, you know, I've let my A5 go or whatever, never did get it, I'm a drivability guy, whatever, but now drivability, does it have to do anything with track control? Oh, yeah. If you got false traction inputs, now the car is behaving like a dog and so forth. So really it's hard to be totally specialized, ain't it? You got to have a kind of a broad range of everything. What's a metering valve do? Let me explain it. Who's a shop teacher in here who's taught the kids this? Metering valve. They've been around a while. Ever since we've had what?
Disc in front.
Disc in front, drum in the rear. What do you got to do when you got disc in front and drum in the rear? Give the right time. Give a little head start on the rear drum. They take a little longer to get the shoes out, right? With the brakes, wheel cylinders, and so forth. Get the primary shoe kicking into the rear, secondary shoe, and so forth. Whereas the disc brakes, well, I mean, there's right on it right now. So the metering has to do with the timing, if you will. Provides the correct apply timing of brake pressure between front disc and rear drum. So that's the metering valve. Been around forever, not ever, since I was a kid, 70s, when, you know, disc brakes came out.
And it was on the line to the front.
And what?
And it was on the front disc brakes.
Yeah. Yeah. What does this guy do? There you can cheat. Look at this. What is it? Proportioning valve. We've always had proportioning valves. Well, not always. Anybody work on antiques? Anybody collect old, really old cars with a single piston master cylinder? You recognize those. Go in an old Navy store, you'll find the old truck, raise the hood, and there's this one place to put, you know, one little cap and one little barrel to put your reservoir of your brake fluid into, and there's just one piston. And if you have one rusty old brake line, few pumps, and you've got no brakes, but tandem piston master cylinders have been out for 40, I don't know, 50 years. It's mandated now, or maybe more, maybe 60 years, I don't know. And those guys, when you push the brake pedal down, you've got one brake line leaking. What happens? You got one or two wheels left that will work, right? So we've split the brake hydraulic system, two pistons, two brake lines, outside of your master cylinder. I'm being Mr. Obvious, so I apologize. But what happens, how do you want to split those two channels up, those two channels of base braking hydraulics? With this car. Who recognizes this car? It's an old car, too. Old GMB car looks like, we used to call it Shamu the Killer Whale. Big Impala, rear drive Impala. How do we separate the brake hydraulics there?
What year is the Impala?
Front and rear, right? Front and rear. So how much front? How much rear, percentage-wise?
70-30.
Almost like an auction here, 75-30. All right. I always heard 60-40, but regardless, a bunch more towards the front than the back. But how about front-wheel drive cars? The proportion of stopping force we get on the front towards versus the back.
80%.
Yeah, it's like 80-20. 85-15, front-wheel drive cars. Rear-wheel drive cars, 60-40, 70-30, something like that. So what decides that proportion? A proportioning valve. Now, how is that affected? So we'll write down, provides the correct pressure of front brakes, which get more weight on them when you decel and you do this, than the rear brakes, more so with front-wheel drive cars, that disproportionate ratio, provides the correct pressure of front brakes to rear brakes. How does ABS affect this part? How does new? Now we're gonna talk about old ABS, but we're going to talk about new ABS too, okay? So new ABS like DRP. DRP, not MSRP, DRP, dynamic rear proportioning. Anybody worked on those cars? Yeah, they're in your shop all the time. Have you been underneath? You probably haven't cared. If it ain't leaking and ain't broke, you don't go looking like an engineer going, wonder how this was made. You know, it's more like, I got to get the job out and make money. But to know how it breaks when it goes wrong, for years we combined these two, and they called that metering valve, proportioning valve together. We called it a combination valve. Got the little wire on there to pop, you know, when you put the brake light to come on. But now have we seen the two together, now a little smaller one, you probably assumed, oh, that's the combination valve, huh? It's the metering valve. Where is that? Gone. It's in software. You've heard of this? A couple of you guys have heard of this. You can detect that the rear brakes are getting ready to lock up. But they've not locked up yet. They're not even starting to go, nothing. But you can detect that begins to happen because we have what at each wheel? Now, if you've got a truck, now they're the most likely to lock up in the back, right? That's why we came out with what? What, in the 80s? R-Wall, yeah, rear wheel anti-lock brakes. The Kelsey Hayes system. Front brakes, we don't worry about them. They're front brakes. Let them be front brakes. One channel of hydraulics went up there unmolested by Freds, okay, and modules and valves and stuff. But the rear brakes we were concerned about because the empty bed on the pickup truck, lightweight. I mean, how many people actually put stuff in their pickup trucks? Basil. How often do you have a lot in the back of your pickup truck? Like 1,000 pounds or something?
How often? In the bed. Probably about every 3-4 months.
There you go. So if we gave him rear brake pressure that would be good for heavy weight, more weight, the more traction coefficient we got in the rear brakes, what would happen the rest of the time when he's not doing this once every 3 or 4 months. Light end, this is going to lock up. So we had the R wall. You don't have to have a proportioning valve anymore. Proportioning valves on pickup trucks, you've all seen them, right? The little arm on them. The bed squats down, a little bit more proportion to the rear because we can handle it. Don't need that, don't need this. We simply use dynamic rear proportioning. The wheel speed sensors, now how many times have you seen pickup trucks that didn't have rear speed wheel sensors on each wheel? Lots, right? They use the toss in the back of the tranny. They might use a pinion sensor for, you know, to direct the axle. Hey, either wheel locks up, one of the axles is going to lock up, and the pinion is going to lock up, and we're going to see that. So we don't care about which tire. But if you want to do DRP, dynamic rear proportioning, you'll have 4 wheel speed sensors. And you look at the 2 rear, and you go, you know what? They're not skidding yet, but they're getting close to it. So back off the pressure to the rears. It's a different frequency and a different sound, so the customer doesn't notice the boom, you know, with the pedal. They just know the back end's not locking up. And you notice that there's no proportioner valve, maybe. But it's in, and it's a PID. It's a PID in the scan tool. So how's it affected ABS? Put down, replaced it. ABS has replaced it in the last 3 or 4 or 5 years, the proportioner valve. All right, everybody seen a layout like that before? Let's go ahead and move on. Useful trivia. If you look at an ABS hydraulic modulator on General Motors, so I talk a lot about GM. I try to talk a little bit about Ford, Chrysler, Toyota, and so forth as well. But I'm an old GM guy, and I've noticed this is cool. Anybody notice the little stickers on there? Somebody last night said, I just need to see one color of brake lines, rust, all right? But... left is purple, red is left front, right rear is yellow, right front is green. That's kind of cool. Now, bleeding facts, more trivia. And you guys probably know this. You know, the novice, like the young tech will go, oh, I have to get my scan tool out. It's got ABS. I got to bleed the brakes. Well, I've been down that road in the VOTEC classes I teach. And it's like, you know, you don't need to unless you absolutely have to. If you don't suspect one of these things, for example, we don't have to suspect the pedal. If you get a good pedal after bleeding conventionally at each wheel, don't bother with the scan tool or, you know, in bleeding the ABS hydraulic modulator. But if you don't get a good pedal after that, then you've got to do that. If the brake pressure modulator valve has been replaced, duh, obviously you got a new one, you got to do that, you got to dance that, you got to turn on modules or solenoids and motors manually or get a scan tool that can do that job. If you have extreme loss of brake fluid, then you got to do it. I just put a set of rear brake lines on my Sebring. Speaking of rust, I have rust on the bottom of this car. The fender's starting to get perforated a little bit. Sebring convertible, I just hate to turn loose of it. I love the old convertible. And my boy, the 20-year-old boy that drives it, loves it even more than Dad, because Dad's on the road all the time, so guess who gets to drive it? And he comes up and says, it's not stopping well, and there's a red light on. Go out there, no pedal. Okay, well, how bad can it be? Probably a wheel cylinder. I get it up on the rack, and it's got rotted out brake lines. So I'm fabricating my brake lines and get up to the little coupler as it goes forward, then up to the hydraulic modulator right behind the exhaust manifold on that car. And I'm thinking, well, this is a big, massive brake leak. I mean, my master cylinder is empty. Didn't need to bleed that hydraulic modulator assembly. In fact, when I followed the manual right off of Chrysler's website with my DRB3, it didn't even work right. It didn't even do what it's supposed to have done. So I'm going, glad the pedal's good, all right? So if it's not broke, don't fix it. If you're not having issues like this, and you just put a caliper on or a wheel cylinder or something like that, don't whip out that scanner or fret and go, gee, I don't have an IDS and it's a Ford and says I can't use my Modus or my OTC or whatever on it. All right. Well, a couple more of these 101s, and then we'll get some deeper stuff. We'll take a break, get you some exercise here, and let you visit the men's room. The efficiency at which a vehicle can brake is determined by the coefficient of friction between the tire and the road surface. Coefficient of friction is higher than that of a sliding. Coefficient of friction is higher than that of a sliding coefficient of friction. So a sliding coefficient of friction over here is a tire that's locked up. And when it's rolling, has got more friction. So we want the tire to roll. The only exception there is in braking is what road covering?
Gravel.
Thank you. Yes, gravel. Because then you're making your tire into a little bit of a gravel plow, making a little bit of a pile in front of it if it's locked up completely. Can you steer, though, locking the wheels up on a gravel road? Not very well. So steering's gone, but at least stopping's a little quicker with a full lockup. But when is the quickest stopping, shortest distance? And here is the chart on 23. Your stopping distance decreases on this y-axis of this chart right here. So when we go down, that's a good thing, stopping shorter distances. And when we have zero, that's a free wheel. The wheel's rolling, same speed as a car. And this is the wheel completely locked up, skidding. What's the best stopping distance on most road surfaces? Somewhere around this point right here, best effective braking. A little bit more detail on the next chart, 24. The braking force goes up, and your cornering force also goes down when you start having a lot of lockup. So obviously, braking force is down, steering friction is down, cornering force is down when we have lockup. Whether it's snow, ice, dry concrete, dry asphalt, it doesn't matter. Where's the best meeting point of steering, the dotted lines, and braking force, the solid lines, on all forms of road surfaces, road coverings, somewhere around in here, isn't it? What is that? Between 15 and 20% lockup. That's all we're trying to achieve. This, you guys knew this. And how fast are we doing it? 15, 20, 30
I like to times. Take something really complex and for my little mind to get around it, make it simplified. I was thinking about stability control systems being traction control for cornering. I was thinking about training a second ago. The training is where an instructor reads up, investigates, talks to people, plays with vehicles in the shop and so forth for 40 hours on one system so they can put together a class and teach you guys in 4 hours so you can get the highlights of it and go out there and break your knuckles and then see how it really works and come back and tell the instructor how it really works, all right? So it's a circle. It's a complete, it's a closed loop system. So please help close the loop tonight. At break time, this gentleman here that specializes in the stretch limos and things like that, he said he had this big E350 van, 16 passenger, wasn't stretched like a limo, but it was a big, long vehicle. And the story, you want to tell the story? Let me tell the story. I'll tell a story. All right, this driver who's been driving for 20-some years or whatever, 40 years, been driving a truck or, you know, vans and stuff like that, delivery, hauling people 40 years, he doesn't think he's doing anything wrong, but the vehicle keeps coming back after the last passenger is dropped off. It's a passenger vehicle, obviously. And the last passenger is dropped off on a rainy day when he brings it back to the barn or whatever, back to the limo place. It's got the stability light on and a buzzer going continuously. And you got to clear the code to put that racket to bed. And when the other younger guy drives it, same slippery roads, no light. And so he did a snapshot, and he found that he was cornering hard, you know, and there was some G-forces and the lateral accelerometers, all those PIDs were showing that we were in a true stability control situation where we had to apply the correct brakes. We were getting loose in the corner, oversteer, understeer, probably oversteer on that big old long thing. And yet, what do? If there's no TSB, no tech tip, all we have is two drivers. You know, it's kind of like, hey, doc, it hurts when I do this. And what's the doc say on hee-haw? Yeah. Don't do that. That's right. So it was you had a kind of a delicate situation of how to tell this veteran driver that you're doing something wrong when you get on a slippery road with no people in the back of that vehicle. It's really light. So that's real-world stuff, and I appreciate hearing about that. So please stop me, ask questions, and jump in with comments, because that's how we all learn. Because like I said, my 40 hours investigating something, and then you seeing it year after year, day after day, and go, hey, you know what, I had a little bit more stability control. I'm going to take more of those jobs on as they come, not farm them out the dealership. And then you really tell us really how it works.
Did you fix the light? No?
I could always reset it. I just had to tell the other driver to bring it back at the end of the day. Never came back on again.
Never came back on since?
Yeah.
I'm wondering where the yaw rate sensor might be on that car. Maybe if it's they cut it and moved it to the back.
It was only the passenger seat, and I checked it because they had the first aid kit and everything. It would always test it out good when I would drive the vehicle.
Yeah. I was wondering if they moved, if they maybe cut the wiring harness and stuck it in the back of the car where it's more sensitive, or I was wondering.
No, they didn't mess with it at all.
No modifications. It's,
he wasn't scared to go fast. The van was. He didn't.
So the block underneath the gas was
put him in the stretch limo and somebody else in that van. All right, we know the ABS makes the wheels stay within a 0 to 12% range of slippage, because some slippage is normal because we're doing it with solenoids typically, except for one system. It was out there for a few years. It finally died. It was in some GM and Isuzu, which were linear. You get the ratcheting pedal. We all know about that and tell our customers about that. We tell our customers ABS doesn't let you drive faster in the snow, right? And they don't listen, but we tell them that. We tell them that it not to pump the brakes when you're in an ABS situation. We're going to talk about software that helps because they do that anyways. In fact, they jab the brake down like they should in a panic stop, then they let up. It's almost like you lose your nerve and let up. I'm not sure why that is, some kind of psychology thing. But the engineers have discovered we can just go ahead and detect that brake stroke push, and we can do some things with some things like brake assist system or vacuum brake vacuum assist system, some things like that, pre-charge and so forth, to make sure that you're sticking with it, even though you're not sticking with it. But we'll have ABS sensors at, you know, one, or as I'm sorry, three or four wheels or whatever, not three wheels, but three places. We know about that. We'll talk a little bit about ABS sensor testing and so forth. We know about release, hold, increase. We'll list all those in a sec. All right, and of course, modulation, when you get into vehicle speed, that's a nice smooth decel, but then you have that delta of a decrease in wheel speed sense. That's when we say, hey, you know, it ain't locked up. Locked up would be like straight down, but it's exceeding the tire's, what we call it, the friction coefficient. So what we're going to do is turn on the solenoids, dump that pressure. So here's your hydraulic pressure, and we're actually seeing pressure sensors on some of these new cars. We're putting them at the master cylinder. We're putting them in the ABS, thank you, in the ABS hydraulic modulator. So we're seeing that as a PID on the scan tool. And so when that happens, you literally, you've had them on the lift, you guys have done this, use your scanner and put the pogo stick on the brake pedal, and all the wheels, of course, you know, are stopped if you've got good brakes, and then you activate one open, decrease of pressure with the scan tool. You should be able to turn the wheel freely. And so the wheel starts turning freely again, it speeds up, and that's when we turn the solenoids off, or put our pressure back up again to it. So it's a constant hysteresis of pressure apply and reduction. Now, let's get just to some systems out of the way real fast here. You guys look at this really easy stick drawing. Obviously, rear drive. And these lines are brake lines right here, the heavier ones, okay? And then these are wires, okay? So that would be a wheel speed sensor for the both rear wheels back in the pinion. And then this is the module. Obviously, it's got wires going to it. There's wire outputs to some kind of a hydraulic modulator here. And a couple light bulbs is what that is. So a little description of what this stuff is. Tell me how many channel system. And what I mean by that is how many choices does this ABS system have to reduce pressure and reapply pressure? It's just got one. Yeah. Now, out of the master cylinder, we just send pressure to the front wheels just like it was the olden days. But to the rear wheels, we're going through this little device here, an R-wall, rear wheel analog system, and so to both rear wheels as a pair. So this is a one-channel system. Now the term integral and non-integral. Integral systems have died out in pretty much in all makes and models, and then they came back again. Not the new end of the sun. Here they come back again. Where they've came back? Hybrids. Because of regen braking. So the integral systems were, I like to call them the Rube Goldberg systems, where it's like overly complex. You know, it's those old cars, like that old 88 Lumina that had ABS. Oh my gosh, and it goes out, so you have to tell your good customer, I'm sorry, we're gonna have to do a little eulogy for your car and bury it, because how can you afford to fix an 88 Lumina with a bad ABS Delco Moraine 3 system?
with the accumulator and the pump and the big modulator in place of a normal master cylinder, no vacuum booster. I mean, it looks like the engineers erased the whiteboard and completely redid it all. And how did they work? Not that well. And were they cheap to fix? Heck no. Could you buy parts for them? No way. Are they still in the salvage yards? Maybe, maybe not. Probably not. So that's when that old car gets, I mean, there's no kits. Samuel Mello's not selling, peddling any kits to replace Rube Goldberg ABS systems with a nice, easy little, you know, master cylinder. So you just junk those out. This is not one of those, is it? This is a non-integral because we have not integrated the ABS hydraulic functions into the base hydraulic function. There's still a tandem master cylinder like you've been working on since you were kids. So we'll put those one channel, non-integral, there. That's an R-wall system. Next page, 28. How many channels is this system? How many choices does the hydraulic modulator have to chop up brake pressure? One here, one here, and that's two, and then a third that tees out back. So it's three choices. So it's a three-channel system. Is it integral or non-integral? Is this married inside of that? No way. No nitrogen-filled canister, no big old hunk and pump. This is a non-integral system. This is very common. This could be four-wall or the EBC 410s or whatever. You know, some of the newer Bosch and Teva systems. Here's another one. Page 29. How many channels is this system? One, two, three, four. Is it non-integral or integral? It's non-integral, all right? Here we go. Here's just the hardware now. You've all seen those. Man, those were like really popular. Did they work like these? Well, in the end, they did. I guess they did ABS, right? But what was the main stuff in here? What reduced pressure to the right front wheel? A motor or a solenoid?
Solenoid.
And it did it rapidly, 15, 20, 30 times a second, right? So with the pedal. How about this system? It's got solenoids. It's also got a motor. That had a motor, but it was a pump motor. These motors control gears.
Huh? Wasn't that for pressure to have that motor, or am I wrong there?
These motors for pressure. Well, okay. These motors were pumps for pressure, for returning pressure in these systems. So the solenoid-based systems, you'd have at least two solenoids per wheel. One to say, no more pressure, you've had enough, kind of like a bartender. You've had enough, no more for you. Cut you off. That's isolation or pressure hold. Another solenoid would then turn on and dump the pressure into a different kind of accumulator, a little spring-filled jobby, not one with nitrogen, just an area inside of here that would say, I'm going to let the pressure escape back into here and no more pressure to the wheel starts rolling again. So pressure control for reduction was done with solenoids. To return it, the pump would turn on and pump the pressure back. But in these systems, that was a solenoid-based system, non-integral. In these systems also, was it integral or non-integral? I know it looks like this is part of that, but can you unbolt that? Because there's your tech tips about unbolting it. You get some leaks if you don't replace those O-rings. So if you got it, you're not going to buy this whole thing when this, you know, 99 Cavalier comes into your shop. You're going to go ahead and just put a new master cylinder on. You got to peel that back off. Does anybody get the O-rings? You should grab some. Yeah, thank good guy. You should grab the O-rings because you could have a leak later. So the transfer tubes and so forth, you can replace gears. If some AC Delco WDs can get you them. I don't know about that, but I know what the book says. You can replace the gears, the motor pack, and the two solenoids at the top. But how did it work? And how did the pedal feel on these versus those solenoid-based systems? These were linear. The two top solenoids were for the two front channels. This was a three-channel system. So we'll go ahead and say three-channel. And that's wrong. I need to correct that next time I teach this class. So write three, not four, like you see. Because you had motors, three motors, left front, right front, and the rears operated off of one motor. hydraulically, you can see cutaway inside of one of these channels or one of these passageways to, let's say, a right front. There's a piston. It had a little pin on top of it to unseat a check ball. That piston was normally almost at top dead center, just down enough to where the check ball would be seated. When you wanted to reduce pressure, you would turn the motor on, 10,000 RPM, 30 amp motor, gear reduction, turn the motor on, and the motor will run a ball screw, and that would allow the piston to move down as pressure was then reduced from the wheel and entered into this expanding chamber. Now, if you wanted to do the right front, same thing here. But the rears, they had two chambers and two pistons, but the two pistons were controlled with one motor, and across the bottom of both those two pistons was a little bracket. Then one motor with one gear would run both rear brakes, pistons down, and both rear brakes would have pressure reduced to them. So if either wheel speed sensor showed a delta getting near loss of coefficient of friction, getting ready to skid, then we would turn on that one center motor and allow both those pistons to come down. So it's called select low. We could select whichever one's the lowest speed giving us trouble. So the right rear may be just fine, going 30 mile an hour like the car's going 30, but the left rear is going 18 or zero. And so we'll run both those pistons down with that one motor. So it was hydraulically, forget I said four, it's three channel system. Now, is it integral or non-integral? It's non-integral. Just because we bolt the hydraulic modulator next to the two outputs. So we're doing a diagonal split like we've always done with front-wheel drive cars. Right front, left rear. Remember we had to have a tandem master cylinder because if you had a brake line spring a leak, I mean, unless somebody cuts all your brake lines, you know, that's murder, right? But if you just have one leaker, you still have two brakes. With rear drive, federal motor vehicle safety standards, I don't care what, two-wheel drive, three-wheel drive, whatever, eight wheels, it says if you lose half your brakes, you still have to be able to hold your foot to the floor on the gas pedal and your foot to also hard the other foot on the brake pedal and it not move. There goes some of the Toyotas these days, right? So if you have a rear-wheel drive car and you have 40% of braking, 35% of braking to the rear wheels, can you hold the vehicle still in that case? Sure. It ain't easy. It might kind of lurch a little bit, but it'll hold still. Front-wheel drive car, only 15% of braking force to the rear. Could you hold her if you had a front-rear split? No. So ABS or no ABS, we do a cross diagonal split, left front, right rear. So that's still left front, right rear, right front, left rear coming out, and it remains that way coming out of here, but the channel of selection is both rear brakes are reduced, or one front or the other front, three choices. And we simply hang this on the side of the master cylinder instead of down along the frame somewhere, or on a Corvette, hanging on the back axle, and some of the C5 Corvettes. And so regardless of where it's mounted, we didn't do away with the conventional master cylinder and what would be behind this thing between the firewall and this guy. Yeah, vacuum booster. We haven't done away with that. So it's non-integral. System has how many solenoids? Two. And how many motors?
Three.
And what happens to those motors sometimes, besides burning up? Nut falls off.
Really? Yeah.
Huh? Ah, I really need to correct this thing, don't I? All right. Right three, not one. And right up here, three, not four. Thank you. Good eye. All right. Now, so if we have two solenoids, if this is a, this other one was a solenoid-based system that had a pump motor, then what is this? It's got three motors and two solenoids. It's a motor-based system. Since the motors move linearly, you know, this much or that much, it ain't off or on, the pedal on those cars, remember these cars? Isuzus? But mainly a lot of GM, right? Pedal would just do this. So people didn't complain as much about that shattering when they went into ABS stop. But the solenoids, what did they do? They didn't decrease pressure like they did in other systems. what I say over here about the bartender. You've had too much to drink, cutting you off. You had too much pressure, I'm cutting you off, no more. Sometimes that's enough to get the wheel to go back in with the friction of coefficient. It's coefficient of friction. Go back into not skidding. Sometimes just isolating. So those are two isolation solenoids for the front two wheels. We don't do that to the rear. There's no responsible bartender for the rear wheels. There's just somebody to back the pressure down by turning that center motor on. All right, move on. Is that an integral or not integral? Yep, Rube Goldberg, you see it on a lot of the luxury cars throughout the 90s. They died out. Have anybody seen these on a 2006 or 8? Anything new? I'm not seeing them unless it says hybrid on the side of it. I looked at G's Honda Civic Hybrid today. Guess what I found? That thing over on the right frame, or body I should say. I look at my Prius, got one of those. You look at a Ford Escape, got one of those. Why are we doing that? Because we're not doing normal braking in the hybrid. Because you think you're pushing the pedal and making the clamps do this, you're not doing that. Maybe do the rears, if it's a front-wheel drive hybrid like, you know, Honda or Toyota. But to the fronts, you're doing a combination of regenerative braking and regular braking, or maybe just regenerative braking at some times. So it's turning into something a little bit different. The system contains, let's say, up to 8 or more solenoids and one motor for a pump. You turn the key on, the pump pumps up. We make pressure. We have backup with this nitrogen-filled canister. And this system's canister, the accumulator they call it, is in lieu or instead of a vacuum booster. So when you see one of these guys, you don't see a vacuum booster.
Because it's a hybrid, it can't have a vacuum, or it really can't work off a vacuum booster if it's electric, right?
Well, the engine may be off. That's a good point. This guy over here says, it's because the hybrid really can't use vacuum. That's a good point, because oftentimes you're driving around with the engine off. You're slowing down. Even the Hondas, when they slow down, they're shutting that engine off a lot. They're killing cylinders with their VTEC system or their variable valve system. They're taking off a lot of the Priuses and the Camrys and so forth on EV mode only. The Ford Fusion Hybrid will go 40 miles an hour with no engine on if you baby the throttle and so forth. So where's the vacuum going to come from? So that's another good point. Also, you want to have regen braking. That's not going to be done with the vacuum booster either. So these systems have been reinvented from the past dark days when we used to condemn the old car that had that, or make your Mercedes owner pay what would something like that cost in your shop for a Bosch or Tavis system on a Euro luxury car. $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000.
I can tell you that the batteries for the GL hybrid are $13,000.
The battery packs? Yeah.
No, the one battery. The one lithium battery.
$13,000 for that hybrid?
$1,000.
What about this kind of system? Not hybrid, just the ABS integral system on a Euro luxury car. In the 90s, you know when we're using those? $3,500. The mid-90s, here's the system's integral. Not hybrid yet. It hadn't come along yet. Mid-90s, here's the integral system. It's a three-channel system in this case, 1, 2, 3. The ABS and the hydraulic braking system itself, the old-fashioned hydraulics we've always had, has been all complicated. It's an integral system, so there's what it looked like. Yeah, we're not going to talk about it much. And there's that brake pressure you're talking about, the nitrogen on both sides, or pressure on both sides of that diaphragm. There's that big pump motor. It was always my impression the pump motor built up the pressure on this side. But I learned something tonight that power steering is doing on some of the Euro cars. All right, more common variety, more we're seeing now. Solenoid-based system. How many channels we got, guys? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 channel, integral, non-integral. That looks pretty normal.
Non-integral.
5 modes of ABS. I'm not even on the brake. Rest mode. What's the next mode of ABS? I'm on the brake, but...
Normal.
Dry road. Normal. What's the next step? I keep picking on you. You probably don't even drink. The bartender guy goes, oh, you've had enough? That's the pressure hold or maintain. and then pressure decrease. We're going to turn on a solenoid. So there's your inlet valve, hold valve, maintain valve. Depends on what manufacturer you're talking about. And then there's your solenoid that allow that pressure to go now this way and fill that accumulator. Not a nitrogen-filled accumulator, this little spring diaphragm. Fill that up, and then the final step is what? Pressure increase, turn the pump on, run the pressure back, and you get the ratcheting pedal. Now, traction control. Not just brakes for tires out of control. The first mode of traction control has always been, on about any vehicle, what? What are all these things? Engine power or torque management on page 37. Four ways to accomplish that. You can do what to the spark timing? Retard it. Reduce it. What can you do to the transmission?
Change it into a higher gear.
Change it into higher gear, right? First car traction control I drove was a Corvette, and I thought the button to turn it off, and usually it's not a rocker button, it's a momentary push button, because when you turn the ignition on, it says it's a new day, and we're going to have traction control default to being on. You turn it off, I used to think that was the burnout button. But as we saw a Mercedes last night, Pierre and G and I driving back from Connecticut, this little Mercedes 5 Series, what was it, like a two-seater with...
It was a C-Class. He was getting stuck. He had performance tires in the snow.
Trying to climb the hill last night. Semi in front of him was slowing him down. The semi's having a hard time. The Mercedes was putting it in reverse on the interstate, trying to give it a little bit of a get up that hill. Couldn't make it. Traction control, if it wasn't there, you would make it out of the snow with anything, even with good tires, because you would keep bogging the engine down with spark retard, fuel injectors being cut out and so forth, electronic throttle being closed, transmission being upshifted, all the things to make torque go away. So the button, you hit the button, and not the burnout button, although you could do a burnout on the Corvette. I got into a Cadillac few years ago and discovered it wasn't a burnout button, because I mean, it's 300 horse North Star, and this thing will bark it before the traction control kicks in. I want to roast these tires. This is going to be some fun. So I hit the button, slammed the throttle down, took off like that. What's going on? Give me my scanner. Put the scanner on there. What's Megan to do that? One of these guys? Nope, this guy. Third gear. I'm taking off in third gear. Because the PCM says, you don't need to do a burnout. It's a Cadillac. You just need to nurse your way up and down, you know, the hill, you know, rocking it in and out. A little bit of slippage is fine. You don't need a lot of slippage, so third gear is just fine. After all this is accomplished, in fact, there were a lot of cars that didn't have anything more than that, right? They didn't have any way to do brake apply. But the second step would be the brake pressure apply management, for lack of better terms. We're going to hit the brakes to the drive wheels. Your foot's not on the brake pedal, so we got to go back to this setup and talk about maybe adding a couple solenoids so that we can prime the system up, turn the pump on, solenoids on the right methods, and we don't really need to know this stuff. A lot of classes spend 2 or 3 days going over all these pathways. That's in a box that you replace. So it's more of the external stuff that we need to know about. And just nice to know a little bit about at least how it works, so it's not a big mystery. It makes us just want to replace parts blindly all the more. So we got all these things doing torque management, and if we are still having a problem, cars with lots of horsepower especially, a lot of little cars with low horsepower, torque management only, you get some big roasters out there that will really, you know, fry the tires even with 100 horse out of 300. We'll go ahead and do something drastic and apply the brakes. That part right there, guys, is the basis of vehicle stability and the basis of hybrid braking. And the future basis, not future, the future is now, adaptive cruise control. They're out. They've been out for several years. And the basis for collision avoidance systems coming out now, and collision mitigation. So that is big, big thing. The traction control, doing brake pressure apply, something we've been used to for years with traction control. Now that's the future. Let's talk a little bit about current stuff. This is like a 06, 07, I think it's a Chrysler 300. Sorry to make you turn your head to the left here. Well, you don't have to, you got a book. You can turn your book. I'll turn my head to the left. To turn this track control system off with a momentary switch, that input grounds this cluster input, so that's an analog or discrete input to the cluster. Where's that getting into the cab, Chrysler? So we call it the controller analog brakes, CAB. It goes data bust to the BCM and then to the PCI bus into the cab module. And then we have wheel speed sensors. So wheel speed sensors, and then of course all kinds of outputs, solenoids and so forth to do traction control work and ABS work, power ground, relays, typical stuff you've dealt with. Now, hardware. We've all seen this stuff. With brake switches, of course. Steering angle switches, how do they work? What's inside those guys? There may be more than one kind, but the ones I've been familiar with, two pots. So think of a couple of APPs, accelerator pedal position sensors, in one unit, and a Petri coil or a clock spring coil, airbag coil. And Chrysler, I know, uses the same coil that carries the wires to this. Now, some of these times, these are down at the bottom of the column. But the same wires that carry the power in the Chrysler, or the signal wires to this guy, also are in the same coil with the airbag. When do you have to reset this guy? Definitely. You put a rack in, you do an alignment job on some cars. Chrysler's got a TSB that says, if you take the battery cable off, you do this, this, and this, and that's one of the thises. You have to reset that. If you don't, nothing may happen. Or the light may be on for stability control. Or, as the case last night, a guy shared with us, you've got an unstable car. Was it a Lincoln? Remember the story?
Yeah, it was a town car. Yeah,
it was a town car, and that sensor needed reset, and it was a pregnant elephant on roller skates whenever it snowed. I mean, it wasn't just I could, you know, whip it around and lose control like any car without stability control. This car would go out of control with the least bit of snow for no reason. It's because it needed that sensor reset. Now that sensor in a late model GM with electric power steering, that sensor initially was you replace the whole electric power steering system. Big bucks. Then Dorman came around. And they have a sensor, so if you have a G6 or a Malibu with electric power steering, we're talking since 05. So this stuff's in your shops now out of warranty. If you have one of those and you have a steering angle sensor that's bad, you know, reset it, sets a code and so forth, gonna have to replace it, then you don't have to throw away the electric steering system at the bottom of the column. You can take it out and you can actually get it from Dorman. I don't know who else sells it, but I know they came in with it. And that you can YouTube it. Go to YouTube and type in steering angle sensor replacement Malibu or whatever. Just those words. A little video come up. Guy shows you how to do it on the bench. You got to take it off the car, so you got to pull the column out. But at least you don't have to put in the whole system. So if you've got a customer that would walk away if you told him how much it was going to cost to put a whole power steering electric motor on there, you at least now maybe you can retain that business. What's this sensor right here? By the way, that's going to be a pit in the scan tool. There'll be degrees, but you can back probe it because it's an analog in a lot of cases, a couple of pots that they keep turning and they're 90 degrees out of phase with each other. So as one turns, the other turns, you know, your 2.5 turns lock to lock, just like a set of wires for an airbag. As this thing turns back and forth, it's just seeing an analog voltage, but it becomes a degree on your scan tool. And what should it say on your scan tool? You're sitting straight ahead.
Zero.
Yeah, it should say zero or maybe one or two. Nothing much more than that. And we'll talk about the procedures for resetting here in a second. How about this guy? We talked about that already. You could have four wires, you could have two wires. If it's two wires, it could actually be still on the bus. It could just be sitting there giving a bus message using one leg of the bus for power and ground, much like some of these wheel speed sensors we're going to talk about here in a sec. Something new. What are we looking at the bottom of right here? Obviously, we know where that goes.
Yes.
That goes to the brake pedal. Mm-hmm. So what must this part be? This is cutaway right here. You can tell this is going a little further out. What are these? In the bottom of the master cylinder, and those will be pressure sensors. So master cylinder brake pressure sensors, aka master cylinder pressure sensors. How about this guy? This is something I'm seeing on GM on 07 and newer full-size trucks and SUVs. Now, we've been seeing those sensors in the vacuum booster for a long time, right? Mm-hmm. Telling you you're low on pressure. Some of the vehicles were having electric motors to kick in. In fact, GM has one that's not on the serial data bus, and it doesn't have ignition to it. It's got B-plus and ground. How does it know when to turn on? When the pressure drops enough is one input. But how does it know the engine's running? The P-terminal for phase, P for phase on the alternator. You know, when you get one of the stators excited, you have three-phase AC in an alternator that's rectified by the diodes. So that P-terminal is like the diesel folks like to use it for attack input. It's used by this little module that controls a pump on some of the SUVs and pickups. It sits right here. The thing's cylindrical, reminds you of an old receiver dryer, only plastic, and it pumps up vacuum. This is a sensor to, you know, to work with. Do I have low vacuum for, you know, vacuum boost? But this is pretty new. This is just out in the last three model years. This is a solenoid for something called active boost. Brake assist sensor or active brake assist. Active brake assist. All right. We all know when you push your foot this way, and you got vacuum on both sides of the diaphragm. It's sealed from the atmosphere on this side. So you got vacuum on this side of the diaphragm, vacuum on that side of the diaphragm. So what's that big heavy metal diaphragm do in the middle? It just sits there, right? But you put your foot on the brake, just basic mass booster 101, all right? You put your foot on the brake, you hear that shh, you're exhausting, if you will, or leaking the vacuum on this side, the passenger side compartment of the diaphragm, this way. That means ambient air pressure's in here. Ambient air pressure is higher than vacuum, and you still got vacuum back here from the engine. What's the diaphragm do? Moves this way, right? So when it moves that way, you've got assist. Now, why would you want assist being given to you by Fred? Hey, I'm perfectly capable of pressing the brake pedal and, you know, doing that little and giving my own assist. Just keep the engine running for me, will you? Or electric pump if I'm slowing down, I don't have any vacuum. I got a diesel, I need, you know, vacuum. What if you jammed this real quick? Now, we're not just looking at an on-off switch for the brake lights and to kick the cruise off anymore, right? Now we got a linear sensor. So you did the delta, whack, like that. Instead of doing whack, oh, I'm going to hit a deer, and you hold it down. Human nature does what? Whack, and then back. It sees that movement, and it says, turn the solenoid on, click, whoosh, and hold it over, like you kept your foot on the brake. It's a little pre-charge. And if they want, they can then also, let's wind up the pump motor and apply brakes through the ABS / TCS system. So that's part of the panic brake assist system. That's a vacuum assist deal. And there's a little tip, technical tip. I don't have to tell you guys this, how to check a solenoid, but it does say don't leave it. Don't put your power probe, dueling power probes, forward power, backward ground for, you know, 10 minutes. It's not a continuous duty solenoid. So just turn it on, see if it clicks, see if it makes the vacuum from the engine, as the engine's running, makes the vacuum move the rod. And if it doesn't, then it's a bad solenoid. If it does, you know, you're looking at the computer or the wiring. Pretty basic stuff. Which leads up to, if Big Brother Fred is helping you apply the brake, maybe even after you release the brake, keep a little brake there for you, we're not only got throttle by wire these days, we've got introduction to brake by wire. Now, I don't know about you guys, but there are certain manufacturers of cars that have had issues with throttle by wire. So I'm not sure I want them to do my brake by wire, all right? Now, certain manufacturers of cars also make lawnmowers, right? You know what I'm talking about. G, you've got one. Not the lawnmower, you got the car, all right?
It's like a lawnmower.
And that manufacturer's arch rival on the other side of the pond, doesn't make lawn mowers, or maybe you thought they didn't. And they're the same ones that have had a little press problems lately. You know what I'm talking about, right? Did you know they came out with a lawnmower, but they immediately recalled it because of it was a throttle-by-wire lawnmower? Here it is. Safety first. Danger, danger, danger. Well, good thing that Durango had ABS, right? Maybe brake assists, I don't know. I'm not so cracked up on this whole brake-by-wire thing after some of the problems we've had with throttle-by-wire, but let's talk about that because that is the heart of stability control systems is a brake-by-wire, a TCS with braking-by-wire. Let's talk about VSIS, VSP, ESP, RCS, all the Ford, GM, Toyota, different names for them. But basically, we're looking at skidding, aggressive driving, slippery road conditions. It's traction control for the hard corner. And we're going to not just traction control for the drive wheels, but traction control for the non-drive wheels, over certain wheels. So this uses sensors to detect steering wheel angle and vehicle direction by monitoring steering wheel position. We've talked about that sensor. Not just the position, but also, what do you call it when you do a quick change? That delta change, is it, this is a really low delta. I'm just driving along on a Sunday afternoon, and this is a quick delta. Now, if I do this at 1 mile an hour, who cares, right? I'm in a parking lot, parking. But if I do this going 60, or as I did yesterday, or no, 3 or 4 days ago, last week, Thursday or Friday, on a big parking lot with three different vehicles with stability control, and the snow was just right, and there were no utility poles, and there's no cops around. And so I'm going 20. Let's see what happens. I'm going to do this. Ooh, a turn or two. Have you ever done that? Sure you have. He's saying, no, I'm a smart guy. I don't get tickets. I don't have crashes. But if you ever get an opportunity with a huge parking lot, you know the cops in that town, or there's nobody around to bother you, whatever, just go out there, put a scan tool on the seat. Maybe it'll be a good excuse out of a ticket. I'm doing testing diagnosis. But just get out there on that snowy surface, give it a quick whip, 20 mile an hour, and see what happens. I'll tell you what I experience, and that is the throttle, I'm keeping the throttle on. And that's not normal to do, right? You don't normally want to keep throttle on and do that real quick going 30. But I did it anyways. And the throttle, the engine, I hear the engine, and I got the throttle at a certain, you know, 20% or whatever. And man, that engine bogs down. And I'm hearing some ABS, but it's a different frequency for the pump, a little different sound. I think I make a note here, one of these slides about that. And of course, I'm looking at my scan tool, and I'm seeing the PIDs for my lateral, my accelerometer for yaw and all that, and seeing the ABS, solenoids turn on, the motor turn on, everything's going on to get the right wheel to have braking force. So it's torque management and a traction control to a particular brake, front or rear. Now, steering wheel position, sideways or yaw, whether it's oversteer or understeer. Vehicle speed, of course, if we're in the parking lot, and we do this real fast, 1 mile an hour, who cares, 30 mile an hour, big deal. It is a big deal. Vehicle's response to steering wheel input, circle that, and then run that up to these two. So circle that and run it up to these two. And what I mean by that is, when I did this at 30 mile an hour, that meant I wasn't in the parking lot because I'm 30 mile an hour, right? And since I did that on a snowy surface, what do you think the vehicle did? Did it go, whoa, like that? No, it just kept going straight. A little bit of an angle, but mostly straight. So when I did a quick delta of steering angle and I didn't see any yaw to speak of, I didn't see any of that, what can we conclude? We've lost stability. Light comes on, FMVSS, Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standards, so you got to have a little icon with the slippery tires. In 2012, the newer, Everybody's got to have the icon, a way to do that. A lot of our luxury cars and stuff have been doing it. My Prius even does it. And we want this, a little bit of this, not excessive. If we don't see any of it, we need to do the stability control. Activate it. So the relationship between those inputs. Here's a little from the GM website here. Little pylon, this Corvette. Now, on the people that did the animation, I love that. See, they had oversteer, they compensated, and the overcompensation. Now, you see those little lights hitting those tires? Makes you think we just kind of alternate, ding, ding, ding. Do we do that with stability control? No. Which tires do you want to apply brakes to when you're in a corner and it's front-wheel drive, for example, maybe dry pavement, but you're overdriving the car, and you can't make the corner, you just kind of go off the guardrail. That's called understeer, right? So when you have understeer, you're doing maybe some lateral, but not so much yaw. So when that's going on, what tire could you apply the brake to help make the corner? A rear or a front? Inside or outside?
One of
inside. An inside or an outside?
Left outside, right inside.
Yeah. So I'm turning right, and I can't quite make the corner. Not oversteering. I'm understeering. Would a right help me axis along that corner? Right front. Now what if I'm oversteering? Left rear. So this thing showed you D, 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 you know, like we're alternating. No, it's picking on one and backing off throttle. And if you want to incorporate it in the whole system, obviously we need a stiffer suspension. So throttle reduction. In fact, Chrysler, that's their big focus with ESP, is they just take throttle by wire. It's like dad reaching over in driver's ed and grabbing the old leg, whack, off the gas, boy.
Are they incorporating the shocks as far as the ride control thing?
Some of the Cadillacs I know have done that,
so
with stability control.
Controlling the braking, the torque,
and leveling. And not leveling, but the stiffening. Ride control, the quality. That would make sense. I wouldn't want sway. Because what happens when you get too much sway? You don't have you lift up. Let's see, I'm in a hard left corner. It sways like this, don't it? And the right rear tire comes off the ground. And then what's that for stability control? Terrible. I put a geostorm into a tight clover leaf one time. Scared that crap out of me. Never drove a geostorm like that again. Three wheels, man. Did my right rear wheel just lift up? It did. There's a picture on page 44 of oversteer and understeer with and without electronic stability control. So if you get confused on which is oversteer, which is understeer, there's a picture. The compensating moment, I like that, with just the right time to apply the brake. So there's a summary of what we're doing. Maybe a standalone system and may incorporate other systems in the vehicle. On 45, reduce torque, activate one or more braking channels, communicate with the PCM, reduce torque, operates in parallel, does not interact. This here says does not interact with ride control system, suspension control, automatic leveling control. That make a circle around there, that's just one system. That's just one system. That sentence was copied out of a description on one system, a Chevy, but you may get into a Mercedes or a BMW or a Cadillac that actually does that. Now, bring it down to real world. You got people that like to change tires. Maybe they were on vacation. And, more likely they're around here and they just go, I think I'll put some big old tires on this thing or some low-profile tires and so forth. Is that going to upset stability control? Yep. TPMS is an issue, yeah. Speedometer accuracy, ABS activations prematurely, TCS issues, on and on and on. So definitely VSIS and ESP and those things are going to have issues. Powertrain loss when entering the highway, exiting the highway, an increased pump noise when turning corners without driver applying the brakes, message activation, the driver information center. And there's my note about pump frequency during a VSIS event is different than that of an ABS event. Now, would that apply to, let's just say I'm on vacation with my my Toyota, and I needed a couple tires. Had a couple flats or something, or they're just getting bald. So I decided to pick up some tires. I had two Michelins of a certain size, and I go buy two more Michelins of the same exact size. Unfortunately, I couldn't get the Previas. I had to get the energy savers. But they're the same size, which means the height, the ratio, the aspect ratio, the tread width, and the diameter are the same. And the circumference is the same, right? I mean, a P215-70R14 circumference should be the same, shouldn't it? One brand to another? I think it depends on whether where the circumference is measured. If you're at Sears and you lay the tire dismounted there on the showroom floor and put a tape measure around it, it's going to be the same between the Previa and the Energy Saver. But when you put that tire and you mount it, is the sidewalk going to be the same stiffness between those two tires? The P ratings and the S, H ratings and all that stuff. I should H and the S and R and Vs and all that stuff, the speed, the sidewall stiffness. So could you have, with a loaded tire, mounted air in it and a car on it, could you have a little different, circumference. So a different circumference. That actually happened to a guy last night in class. He says, I had four Michelins on a customer's car. Two were of one model of Michelin, exact same size as the other two, but there's a different model, and it had issues with stability control. And that was the reason. Speaking of four-wheel drive, the stability control system, stability control system does not affect the ratio of front to rear torque. If all-wheel drive systems, you know that divvy up the torque to front and rear. Here's a diagnostic tip for General Motors. Perform the following if the EBCM, yaw rate sensor, lateral accelerometer are replaced or different sized tires are installed. So you didn't put different as far as front to rear. You just maybe went up a size. You know those alternate sizes you're allowed to do and your speedometer's not going to be off very much at all, if any. When you do that, this is the way to do it without a Tech 2. Turn the ignition off, disconnect the yaw sensor, start the engine. You're going to set a code, but it says do it anyways. Put the brake on firm and hold it. Turn the ignition off, reconnect the yaw sensor, turn the ignition on, clear the codes. You just reset that sensor. That's pretty easy. No factory tools involved. I like that stuff. SUVs, how do they do it? Same as the cars. Anticipates brake application. How does it anticipate brake application? Well, short of some newer system we're talking about with the smart cruise control, adaptive cruise control. That brake application anticipation is that quick jab where you didn't really then actually apply it hard. It anticipates that. Do a pre-charge of the ABS. Maybe do that vacuum solenoid in the vacuum booster. Monitor sensor feedback. Holds pressure in the system. Releases a pre-charge if not needed. And as always, when you have ABS kick in, what's the headlights do? Your customers are saying, yeah, that alternator's still not working right. Well, headlights are dimming. Yeah, were you in a corner hard? What's that got to do with anything? I know when I hit the ABS on snow, it does it, but it's doing it even on dry roads. Yeah, are you hitting the corners hard in the dry roads? Because that's going to make the system kick in and the headlights are going to dim because it's, 30, 40, 50 amps. Picture of a what here? Alignment job, stability system disabled. You need to reset the steering angle sensors, and sometimes that's simply a matter of disconnecting the battery that makes that, initiates the need for that. Other times it's when you replace the master cylinder, one of these sensors and so forth, a VSIS may need initialized, and the angle sensor may be initialized, EBCM's replaced, steering wheel sensor of course replaced, alignment. You could add down here, battery disconnect. Chrysler's got a TSB here we'll look at in a second. And there's some PIDs. You guys can look at that another time. We'll just move on through there. But, you know, you're going to see positions, the conditions of all the solenoids, the yaw sensors, throttle angle, all these things that have to do with ABS, TCS, and the stability control. Somewhere in here, I think there is a lateral accelerometer right here, negative 1.2 to one, positive 1.2 on the range. So just a sample PID list. And we'll skip these. You guys know basic diagnostics. I will kind of light on this last one, though, 55. Since ABS is the, slash TCS, i.e. wheel speed sensors, are the heart of stability control, that means our ABS wheel speed sensor diagnostics, we better be on our top game, right? So hold up your hand if you use a lab scope. Hold your hand up if you use a lab scope. Okay, about half, a little bit more than half, cool. And for the rest of you guys, use a meter. You're probably doing a good job at it. So what we're seeing up here on this page 55, that's pretty much how you check wheel speed sensors. I mean, you use your scan tool, of course, but if you want to do a little bit deeper diagnosis, put it up on the rack, spin the wheel. You're sticking your meter, you're back probing a connection where it's convenient. You're spinning the wheel over and you see some AC voltage. Those of you guys who are scopers, you're looking for a sine wave. Amplitude and frequency go up as the wheel turns faster because it's an AC generator, right? Okay, usually. And so you see how many millivolts on a scope. I mean, just because you see something on a scope, does that mean it's good?
No.
You know, I can take an old 92 Chevy pickup with a really weak pickup coil and get a scope pattern out of the pickup coil and it won't start. I need to look at that scope pattern and see if it's 200-300 millivolts. Like, crank that distributor over. Same thing here. What is the number? What's the number you guys go by? Share it with the rest of us.
0 to 1200?
The voltage AC you'd see when you spin the wheel by hand on the rack. What would be a minimum you'd say would be okay?
Maybe 2 to 3 volts AC.
Huh?
Approximately 2 to 3 volts AC.
2 to 3 volts? Okay. That'd be good. Great if you get it that much. It's pretty much a lot like an old distributor pickup coil. It's 300-400 millivolts and higher, you're okay. You start seeing 100, 150, it may not tell the EBCM that you're turning enough. And going back to some basic stuff, it's going to help us a lot when we get into the stability control system, considering every car is going to have it in a couple of years. Wheel speed sensors. Yeah, comparative is great. Yeah, because what's the chances of all of them being weak or bad? I like that. So if you've got wheel speed sensor signal missing on page 56, 45, 45, 45, zero likely causes, what are you guys looking for usually?
Sensor harness.
Yep, what else? About open, shorted, sensor, tone ring gone, sensor dismounted. Those would be possibilities. How about an erratic speed? 25, 25, 25, 20 to 25 all over the place.
Rust.
How about damaged tone ring? How about a bad wheel bearing?
Yeah.
Now, not every car has, you know, a specific code like this. But some of them have open, short, erratic, and no output, missing output. How about a wheel speed sensor out of phase? 55, 52, 51, 55.
Or a wheel bearing put in wrong.
Really? I've never seen that. Oh, too close to the tone ring's out.
No, the bearing has to go in one way.
And if it doesn't, what happens?
The wheel bearing has
a magnet
on one side of the wheel bearing. Honda's it backwards.
Honda's too.
Yeah. Even the BMW has them.
You can get the wires reversed to have problems too. You can get the wires reversed to have a problem. Wheel speed sensor out of phase, 55, 51, 52, 55. Mismatched tires, tire inflation. Now, here's a little case real quick here. Four wall, three sensor. Old Astro van, high mileage. This guy wanted me to look at, is one of these Anvil Tech shops in town. And I don't know why, but sometimes I answer his calls. He doesn't have a computer.
And he doesn't have a library of books either, okay? So what's that tell you? He's got a scanner. He's got a meter. It's an old Matco or some kind of Mac / Genesis kind of thing. And a lift. He does good transmission work. He can get engines in and out like that. You know, he's just a good old boy. But man, something like that comes up. He's kind of lost. Once in a while, I help him out. And this vehicle, he had already worked on the code for the wheel speed sensor. Right front kept locking up under 5 mile an hour. And he said, I took it out. I replaced it. I cleaned it, whatever. How good did you clean it? So we start to look. And I looked at codes with my tech, too. The right front wheel speed sensor missing, sure enough, intermittent. Stop lamp circuit. I never did figure out what that was. It finally cleared and then come back. I like that. I was being a smart aleck here. Did somebody steal it? It's missing. And it says there's 3 wheel speed sensors in the write-up. Even said on the Tech 2. So I'm thinking, I thought there was always 4, but then I remembered there's one on the differential, you know, that takes the place of. And sometimes it's in the toss, in the back of the transmission, and then you get VSS, of course, from that. And then that is from the TCM, for example. There's a good PI from General Motors on late model GM trucks and vans that basically says, are you confused about where VSS comes from? Well, it all depends on where it's going. If it's to the nav radio, if it's to the PC, to the ECM, you know, for torque converter, clutch lockup, things like that, or I should say apply of EVAP, something like that, then it's a 4,000 pulse per mile speedometer, 4,000 pulse per mile signal from the TCM. But if it's a ABS, what's the rear wheels doing? Either rear wheel, we're looking at the drive shaft, aka the back of the transmission output speed sensor, TOS, and that signal is just not fast enough for ABS, so they bump it up to like 128,000 pulses per mile, and that goes to the ABS module. So there's a lot of confusion that PI kind of clears it up. But in this case, that PI hadn't even been published yet. I'm just kind of looking in the service manual, and I see this on page 60. And I just took a quick look, and I go, 1, 2, 3, 4 wheel speed sensors. Wow. I go looking for the ones in the rear, couldn't find them. You see any problem with 1, 2, 3, 4? We've got to get our glasses on, don't we? Late and early, 2 wheel speed sensors. So where's the third, the scanner, and the service manual told me? In the back of the transmission, all right? So I'm having a right front go bad anyway, so skip all that. So I start putting my meter in there, in the connector, and this is what I got. We'll skip all that. You guys know how it works. There we go. There's what my meter was showing, upper left, on the left front, which was good, right front. Hey, he's putting on a signal. It's half the left front. And there's my scope. I apologize. Not a very good, it's my old Fluke 97 before I got my Pico this few years ago. So this is kind of ratty looking, and this actually looks a little more decent. The voltage, this is what they're supposed to look like. Now, this is Lance Mossman, IATN case. I did some research. He had the exact same thing a few years before I worked on this car, and he was showing what was going on with the hydraulic modulator assembly. We were doing that to the right front wheel because when I got under 5 mile an hour, I was getting a signal, but it wasn't enough. And so the EBCM says, I care about 5 mile an hour. I don't care about 1 mile an hour. I care about 5. And at 5, it drops down to 150, and that's below the threshold. So it mistakenly thought the right front wheel was locking up. And so you guys have seen this, right? Nasty, gnarly, clean it up. This guy swore he cleaned it up. And that's what it looked like. that was clean. Gee, Larry. The guy's name is Larry. And so that's what it's supposed to look like. There's actually an ITN photo, but I cleaned it up and fixed the car. So what we learned that what's a proximity sensor, isn't it? AC generating proximity sensor, and cleanliness is essential. Now, are they all proximity AC proximity sensitive? AC generators. Now, here's a Chrysler. And GM started doing this in about 05. Chrysler's been doing it what? Back in the 90s. So you hop on there with your meter, and you don't look for AC. What do you look for with the meter?
Volt, regular DC voltage, and then...
Well, here's a little Rube Goldberg thing GM's showing us. They just kind of jumped in 2005. Chrysler's been doing it a while. This is how they tell you to check a digital or active wheel speed sensor. Take your meter out. They've got a J number for the terminals, of course, for the little jumper wires. We'll use the universal set that we have in our toolbox. But you unplug the sensor, and the sensor is turned around. So this will now connect with that. So we've unplugged it and turned it 180 degrees. So we put a positive in here, a negative in there, and now we're in what mode? Amps. So now we hook a jumper wire to complete the circuit with the open part of the circuit. And my finger's sticking there. There we go. So I hook up the sensor.
Doesn't a company make a jumper that fits in there?
Yeah, AES. Pretty sure AES makes them. AES Wave. Turn the amps. There, 7.5. Watch. I'm going to turn the wheel. 7.5 milliamps. Turn the wheel slow. So the wheel's moving real slow here. 14.7. 14.7. 14.7. That's a lot of work. But if you have a meter, that's what you're going to do. Now, would you put your amp clamp on that wire? And what do you guys back at the back tables think? Would an amp clamp be accurate 714, 714? I'm a little sketchy on that. I think I'd rather see this. So you scopers, by the way, do you need a scope or a meter for this one that was in G's shop yesterday?
No.
Yeah. That would be like the quarter wave antenna. This is the quarter teeth tone ring, all right? We got some teeth missing here. I thought I had a waveform, but Pierre shared with us last night the beamers were 1.5 to 2.5.
They're
1.5 to 2.
They're 8 volts open circuit if you disconnect it. It's a Hall effect that uses an internal ground in the computers. It's a two-wire Hall effect. Fools you.
Yeah.
And it actually cycles between 0.5 and 2.5. So it's got
0.5, 2.5?
0.5 to 2.5.
So okay.
It's a 2-volt range, but it's still a square wave.
I scoped the Escalade that I was driving around here a while back, and it was 12.5, put on the Pico. Unfortunately, my hard drive died on my main workhorse Dell computer. So I lost a lot of good stuff. That wasn't backed up. I just had did it. And now a lot of other stuff was backed up, but my Tech 2 snapshots, anybody have a Tech 2? All right. Have you ever figured out where to hide your Tech 2 snapshots where it's not in that little never-never land of TIS? Because you can put it to a floppy, which who uses floppies now, or you put it in that never-never land. If you put it in a folder of your choice, your choosing, you'll never be able to get it back out of there. It'll be some format you'll be able to recognize.
I have never saved anything, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Not on that.
Right. But
if I really wanted to say something, is it Varus, if I need to save scope pattern or something, I can just plug into it and it's good enough to get.
Yeah. G had a great idea for me the other day. He says he doesn't mess with all the resident software to save stuff. He just gets one of those free screen recorder programs you can download from the web, and you can either take a snapshot picture, which is becomes like a, what do they call it, MPEG, like a picture file of whatever's on your screen, or you can make a movie of it. You can record it in a movie and make it a M4, MP4, whatever they're called. And those you can always put in folders and pull them off to a floppy or a jump drive. Take them home. And you never lose it. If the shop computer dies, you've got that. You know, if you're storing stuff for posterity, for, you know, hey, what's this supposed to look like? Because, you know, 6 months ago when I scoped one of these active sensors.
You always save everything in IATN.
That's a lot of guys do. And so how do they get it on there? I guarantee it's not a Tech 2 file. It's going to be some kind of file that anybody can read. All right. GM specific information. There's some PIDs on a near skid with a 2009 Tahoe going 72 miles an hour. And what was going on here? We did have one outlet solenoid commanded on the right rear as I put some yaw into it, 2.5 volts, and some lateral 2 degrees of steering wheel angle. So I whipped it just a little bit on a lane change, and I did get a little bit of activity here. but I hadn't quite got into a total ABS, you know, activation and so forth, panic, anything like that. Dynamic rear proportioning was not active. I wasn't on the brake. I was on the gas. So there's your PID for getting rid of what? Old-fashioned part? Proportion. The proportioner.
Would you say you were braking there?
No, I was on the throttle. Where's my throttle at?
Yeah, I'm looking at brake booster vacuum at minus 224044 inches.
Yeah, it's got vacuum on it.
That's a lot. Is that just 22 inches? 22,000.
See, where's my brake pedal? No panic assist. Brake pedal position signal released. So I was just cruising and did this real quick, couple degrees, and see what I had.
See, I like that one too, so I can get a number that this
guy. All right. This PI right here, if you want to write this across it, wiring fix. Well, we got a bunch of codes that have to do with the stability control system. It's the Bosch 5.0, 5.3 system. And we got a yaw sensor. We got a steering wheel position sensor. Codes for one or all of those. What else we got? Lateral, yaw, steering wheel position sensor. What's the chances of having three of those sensors out? They all three got codes. Pretty slim. So it's a 5-volt issue that they address. So, but if there's a PI in there, you know those wires are getting chafed. So the point is, they're just saying, don't go replacing sensors because you got codes. And wouldn't that be human to do? Stability control. Man, that stuff's wild. Gee whiz. Y'all, I don't know. Y'all, that's what they say down south, you know. So you put a sensor on. I'd be tempted to. Hopefully after tonight you won't. And they're just saying, this particular group of vehicles, where's the list of vehicles? Yeah, I don't have that list on there, unfortunately. But this is, you have to look up the PI-3015 by number to figure out the list of vehicles. I apologize, I don't have that in there. But if it's Bosch 5.0 or 5.3, it's not a truck, it's got Cadillac. There's more Cadillac and Buick. This one is a flash fix, bottom line. But they still want you looking for harness issues and so forth, inspecting, making sure that yaw or accelerometer, yaw sensor or lateral accelerometer are bolted down properly. Chrysler, what I've got on them, a couple examples of the bizarre or the difficult and the easy. Here's a 2004 Grand Cherokee. You know, you disconnected the battery, you replaced the steering column, you did something that you need to do a re-zero on the steering angle sensor. And the bottom line is, I put it in red, you turn the key on, you turn the steering wheel all the way to the left so it locks, all the way to the right so it locks, back to the center, you're done. Well, that was easy. Now another Chrysler, here's a Challenger. Again, you did something where you've got to you maybe adjusted the toe on your rack, and you got to readjust the steering angle sensor, connect the scan tool. And maybe or maybe you don't have that feature with your scan tool, follow directions on the scan tool. So it's a scan tool only, this ESP-equipped vehicle. And Toyota, let's see. Toyotas have ways to do it without the MasterTech or the TechStream Lite. Have you ever seen a connector on the firewall that looked like a breakout box that was shaped like that? They're calling it DLC-1. DLC, I'm thinking, you know, the 16-pin deal for your OBD-2 under the dash, that's DLC-3 on the Toyotas. So DLC-1, there's a DLC-2, I'm not sure I've found that yet in the manual or if it exists, but DLC-1 looks like this, and you jumper wires just like you did in the old days of GM, and you get that light flashing, like with the Chrysler or GM, and which light flashes depends on what you're doing. So I won't go through this in detail. This is just for your convenience. You work on a Toyota, pull this handout out of your toolbox or out of the office and read up on the flash code diagnostics, because maybe you can't read some of the chassis codes with your particular scan tool. Just don't do it. So try flash code diagnostics. And you can't clear codes. There's four steps to clearing codes. It has to, step number three, you're doing the jumpering again. You're watching these things flash, but then you pump the brake pedal 8 times in 5 seconds to clear the codes. Kind of clever. And then a manual wheel speed sensor checkout. Same thing. You're jumpering wires, starting the engine, going for a drive over 30 miles an hour for several seconds. And you come back, and then you jumper another wire, as the steps tell you. And it then blinks to determine if you have a problem or not. And there's a list of the wheel speed sensor codes. By the way, speaking of codes, you got a good old plain old-fashioned wheel speed sensor that puts out an AC signal. If you spun the wheel and it's putting out an AC signal and you're still setting the code over and over again, and it was enough of a wheel speed sensor voltage, I mean, it was, let's say, it's 2 or 3 volts. When you spun the tire fast enough, what would you conclude was wrong? Could it be wiring? Sure. What should the wiring, I mean, you could ohm the wiring out, but what should you get at the connector unplugged?
The key, huh? Should, 5 volts reference.
Yeah, you should, if it's an analog AC producing wheel speed sensor, one side of that circuit's tied to ground in the EBCM, the other side's tied up to power or 5 volts, one or the other, through a high ohmage resistor. I've had repeat ABS codes, good sensor, tech put more sensors on, and it was a burnout resistor circuit. The side of the module itself was bad. So sometimes the module can be checked really easy at the wiring harness end. Unplug it, see if you got voltage there. Because it's a voltage divider network, just like you have, you know, if you unplug your idle intake air temp sensor to put an air filter in, you forget and leave it unplugged, what happens? Light comes on. How'd the computer know that? Because it didn't see that voltage drop across that other resistor of the thermistor. Another resistor inside of Fred's head that compares the two. Same thing in ABS. Deceleration sensors on Toyotas, mechanical with a little LED and a photo transistor that kind of moves like a pendulum. And those, there's an adjustment for those. And make sure they're tight and so forth, a way to test them. There's the digital accelerometer type. And more shorting and using the meter again, deceleration sensor checkout. And finally, resetting the steering angle sensor on Toyota. What are we doing again? Don't have the scanner. You can do the shorting of the pins again. So I like that. I used my MasterTech on my Prius when I worked on it, which leads me up to, almost leads me up to something. If you don't have a factory scanner and you've got one of those Challengers or whatever, and then you got a Volvo next week and you got something else next week, who's got an alignment rack? All right, got a Hunter? Something fancy?
Jim Beam.
Okay. No one's got the Hunter? If you had the Hunter, there's, I don't know what the other one's doing, but they've got an addition for about $1,000. This is wireless. It plugs into the DLC, but the guy holds it. It's wireless to the alignment rack, and it resets, they say, almost all of them, all the steering wheel angle sensors. So that's something to think about if you ever start working in a shop and you got the fancy Hunter. Leads me to the last thing, a little case study here. Why do we really need to know about stability control, brake by wire, and all the basic foundational things like wheel speed sensor checkouts and stuff? Because we're getting to brake by wire, and that stuff's scary. That's my Prius, well, not mine, mine's gray, but I got an 04 Gen 2 Prius, 78,000 miles on it, and 150 miles from home, the brakes completely go out. I mean, let's put it this way. It'd be like having one pad that was barely making contact. So if you had like an aircraft carrier landing deck, you could get stopped with both feet pushing the brake pedals hard as you can, panicking and praying the whole ways. That was what happened in my car. I got to do a hybrid class. I want to use my own car, much to my wife's dismay. I talked her into the hybrid. I said, honey, we need a hybrid. You can get rid of that minivan, gas guzzling thing. Now, I'm not a tree hugger. I'm the wrong guy. But I like technology. And what better way to learn a new technology on these cars than to own one? And I'll use it in classes, too. So I drove my Prius, right after we got it, right up to Detroit, to Delphi, to do a training class for train the trainer. And everything worked out great. I had the lid of the inverter off, you know, with the proper gloves on, showing guys how to handle stuff. And we did some testing, put it back together, cleared codes, drove it like, I don't know, halfway back to Indiana, about 100 and some miles. Stopped for lunch. Everything was fine. Come back after, out of the restaurant after lunch, turn the key on, actually push the brake pedal, hit the power button, and all the lights came on. Instead of going back out with a ready light on, all the stability, ABS, TCS comes on, blinking, winking, buzzing, this thing right here, the buzzer, buzzing away, and I go, oh, this isn't good. What could I have maybe done or let knocked loose or whatever when I did my training? Oh gosh, here I am in the middle of Coldwater, Michigan at a restaurant near the interstate, 150 miles from home. Oh well, maybe it runs okay. Through the parking lot, almost hit another car. The brake pedal's doing this, and not much of anything else. I mean, I'm telling you, it took, you know, 20 car lengths to stop from 10 mile an hour. It just wanted to keep on rolling. And I'd always read there was a backup default system. It never would happen like that. Just like though it couldn't happen that the throttle would stick and those people would have to have, you know, state troopers help them stop, you know? Baloney. It happened to me. Not the throttle part, but the no brakes part. So, you know, I'm checking fuses in the, you know, the parking lot, pulling relays out, whatnot, pulling codes with my tech stream, clearing codes with my tech stream, seeing codes come back with my tech stream, three codes. One of them said no communications, the EC, hybrid ECU, and the skid sensor, or the skid anti-skid module. Another code said bad relay, ABS number one, and the third code said bad ECU, anti-skid module. Ooh, that didn't sound good. And they all kept coming back. I did figure out if I pulled the relay, I had no chattering brake pedal and about 10% brakes then. So being the cheap guy that I am, I didn't flatbed the thing home. I drove it on the interstate. You know, you can drive a car 10% of your brakes with lots of prayer on the interstate. It's just off the interstate is the scary part when you have to get those side roads to get home. Get it in the garage, start doing diagnostics, call my buddy at the Toyota hotline. He says, yo, you got all three of those codes? We've been seeing cases, it's always wiring. So I tore the dash apart looking for problems. I mean, have you ever had a Prius dash apart? It is incredible. It is packed and packed and packed with stuff and read up on the system, and this is what we found. We have a skid control ECU. That, if you circle that, that is the king of logic. There's another unit, a brake actuator. I want you to go ahead and label that ABS hydraulic modulator. ABS, what do you call them? H, hydraulic modulator assembly, HBA, whatever, hydraulic unit. It had lots of wires. So it's not a dumb little thing just taking orders from this. It's its own module. It looks like any ABS slash TCS unit you've seen with a few more wires. All the brake lines go into it and then come out of it. And then you've got, of course, wheel cylinders, calipers, and so forth. A hybrid control ECU is also working with this guy and talking to this guy on a CAN bus. As we look a little bit more on here, I'm going to skip that. That's just about regen braking. You guys know about that. This gives a little description of how it works. To kind of summarize it, we've got a brake pedal stroke simulator that you've got a little miniature master cylinder that is not really there to stop the car by itself, really, truly. It can if everything's right. You've got a brake stroke simulator. So when you hit the pedal, you've got the feel like you've got a conventional car with brakes, but you don't. When you're in the brake assist mode, which is the normal mode, you've got hydraulic braking that's applied by Fred, compliments, this is the Fred here, via a traction control type of a setup. So that hydraulic modulator assembly that normally would only be used if you were burning out or in a stability control situation, traction control, right, or stability control, it's used just to apply the brakes, period, in a normal stop. That is if you want to use front brakes. You probably don't want to use front brakes because you're going to use regen braking almost all the way down to 5 mile an hour, unless you're in a panic stop or the battery pack is fully charged up. The rear brakes don't have any regen braking. They're just wagon wheels, so they'll get some brake-by-wire apply. The front brakes, if you have the system go out, are supposed to go back to a manual system. Now, how do we apply this? Remember the integral system we're talking about, the nitrogen-filled accumulator and so forth, and a pump, and that's how they apply the brakes. And that's how it's supposed to work when the system goes out, when this goes out or whatever. But I'm telling you, I was in a situation where it didn't work that way. So So I'm desperately wanting to find the wiring issue that the Toyota TAC guy told me about. Didn't find the wiring issue. Got desperate. By this time, my wife's saying, I told you you shouldn't took our new car to work on it in class. Now she's saying, are you sure you know how to work on hybrids? Are you sure you know how to cook? You know? Them are fighting words, man. But I understood, you know, she's been without a car for like a month. I play this thing on the weekends when I'm not on the road traveling. So she says, honey, I want to help you in any way I can. Can I hold the flashlight while you work on it or whatever? I said, you want to help me? I said, I've been over to the Toyota dealership and they want $1,280 for this wholesale. And I'm pretty sure it's bad. Pretty sure thing. It was never a conclusive thing. But I was really 90% sure. I said, try and find one on eBay, okay? Find one used at a salvage yard. I figured she wouldn't. She found one in Detroit at a body shop / salvage yard specializing in hybrids owned by some Russian guys for $75. Wow. I said, for $75, I can afford to have this as a, you know, a conversation piece if it doesn't work. We plugged it in, fixed it. So the moral of the story is brake-by-wire stuff. If you read this handout when you get home or tomorrow at breakfast, read this description. It is way up here. The Fords are using it. The Toyotas, the Lexus are using it. It is all that integral stuff you thought you were done with. It's stability control. When I got done with this module, I had to use my scanner to reset the VSC, vehicle stability control system, and the steering angle system. So it's going to get complicated. And this is a 2004, way out of warranty.
Did you tell Toyota about that just because it didn't
default? Yeah, no, I need to call that guy up on the hotline and say, first off, it wasn't a wiring issue. Secondly, so much for that theory of having decent brakes. Not the greatest brake, you have decent brakes. I had almost no brakes. It was a very, very, I wouldn't allow my wife or my son to drive the car. And I would, after I got it home, I was probably should have flatbedded it. After I got it home, I would only do like, you know, around the block, you know, residential, just road testing to see if I had it, you know, with a four-way flashers on, because it just didn't have brakes to speak of. So brake by wire is here, guys, and as always, TST is here with anything comes out new. Thanks for coming tonight. Hope you don't need stability control on your way home. Drive safe, and God bless.